Ladies and gentlemen, we're live. It's the 12th day of May, 2016. We are about to kick off a global transmission of extremely important intelligence and analysis. Mike Norris, of course, Chuck Norris's son and filmmaker, documentary filmmaker, TV producer in his own right, is joining us with billionaire Gary Haven, good friends of mine, to talk about the kickoff of their new film, Amerageddon. We have Roger Stone with some of the biggest intel yet on what's happening inside the meetings with Paul Ryan and Trump right now, plus VP info. It's all coming up. But first, a John Bowne report.
This is what the residents of London have come to expect from the million-plus Muslims now living in areas they no longer feel safe living in or even visiting.
This area here used to be inhabited by the indigenous people of Burnley, which would be British.
They're moving to our community, and as you say, crime rate goes, sex, they're wanting our girls, walking down the road at night time and you're getting stopped, how much love and all that. We can't come out after dark, can we?
No, my daughter.
And the kids bully our kids.
Yeah.
Like, they all team up on our kids, so our kids can't play out, they've got to be in all the time. Do you know
what I'm talking about?
But this area was once a working class British community. And now it resembles Bangladesh. Rise up and say, enough is enough. This is our country. We don't want any more coming into this country. We don't want any more immigration.
I just got told to leave.
You run the country?
Yeah.
You run the country, do you?
Yeah.
I don't want to embarrass you in front of your community. Is that the best you've got?
Britain!
Go back to the desert.
This is Britain. We've got every right to be
desert.
Here.
Go on, stopping it.
For what?
What? This is our country. Why don't you go back to your own country?
Britain, are you telling us to stop? Who are you talking to?
Out there, and all that evil you see on the streets, people not wearing hijab properly, people smoking, people walking like they got something stuck in their hands. Yeah, these kind of things, you should hate it. You should hate walking down that street.
This poster is basically showing how we will transform Buckingham Palace into a local mosque for the Muslims.
Drugs will be banned, pornography will be banned, gambling will be banned. We do expect to enter into a struggle, if you like, of words, and maybe even more than that, before we can see the fruition of the Sharia, really, on state level.
Muslims are here to stay!
Muslims are here to stay!
These people come into our country, setting up their own legal system. Enough's enough.
But none of the evidence of internal malice towards the United Kingdom's host population by a growing Muslim population even exists, according to London's new Muslim mayor, Sadiq Khan. In fact, Khan, a Labour Party favorite, is making no qualms about the rhetoric coming from across the pond via presidential candidate Donald Trump. Trump had expressed an exception to Khan visiting the country in lieu of Trump's temporary ban on Muslims entering the United States. Khan defied Trump's remarks with his own narrow rhetoric. Apparently, Khan is no leader, just another globalist puppet passing out blinders to the general population. In fact, Khan, barely a week into his role as London's mayor, is hurling veiled threats at the United States. His claim that Donald Trump's stance on Muslims is based in ignorance and that Trump's continued rhetoric will only lead to more attacks is a foolish statement to begin with. Hello? If Trump is ignorant on Muslim aggression being a reality, then why should we expect attacks? Khan has spoken at numerous events right alongside jihadists, including, as The Sun reported, a rally in 2006 with an extremist Muslim leader who threatened fire throughout the world. Sadiq Khan later defended Dr. Azam Tamimi, a senior figure in the Muslim Association of Britain, for using flowery language. London Mayor Sadiq Khan will be traveling to the United States and meeting with other globalist tool mayors like Chicago's Rahm Emanuel and New York City's Bill de Blasio. Because it's vitally important to establish a network of global tyranny and the will of the multinational corporations on the local level. Mayor Khan, the people of the United States don't intend on committing our sovereignty to the trash bin of history. Your feigned ignorance of the true state of the refugee invasion preying on innocent Europeans and Americans is just as blatantly false as your mayoral
campaign. That's John Bell. Welcome, my friends. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us on my second broadcast of the day. I did a couple hours of Coast to Coast AM in the morning hours today. Always great to be on with George Norrie. And I really like doing radio via telephone, sitting there in my living room with my feet kicked up. I can really kind of calm down a little bit and get into some deep thoughts. But always great to be with George Norrie. Appreciate him having me on the broadcast. It was great to visit with his giant audience. We talked about a lot of the big issues we're about to mull into right now. Roger Stone, again, the top Trump insider, one of his best friends, former campaign manager, called me early this morning and he said, okay, I want to come on. Because he says, I only come on when I have something to talk about. Sometimes I ask him to come on. He goes, no, I'm not ready to right now. But sometimes he comes on 3 days in a row. Sometimes he comes on every 2 weeks. He's a really interesting guy. And I'd actually interviewed him like 10 years ago in one of his JFK books that was a bestseller. And I'd seen him at some JFK events in Dallas, but I've gotten to be good friends with him. He's really smart. And he doesn't make stuff up like so many other pundits and analysts do, not just on air, but behind the scenes. He does exactly what he says he's going to do. And what he says comes true like 99% of the time. He really is smart. And he knows what he's talking about. And I was driving into work today for like 30 minutes talking to him. And, you know, this is on record. This is off record. This is going to happen. And it's just amazing to have that perspective from his bird's eye view. It's also a minefield to try to not step on toes and not release information I'm not supposed to. But he's going to be joining us in about 2.5 hours at the bottom of the third hour. And he's going to be getting into exactly what's really going on inside the ongoing meeting between Donald Trump and the so-called Republican Speaker of the House, Mr. Ryan. And he's also going to talk about Lewandowski, who he, behind the scenes, has had issues with, because Lewandowski makes it all about himself. He finally came out in Newsmax, Daily Caller, InfoWars. Some of the stories were on DrudgeReport.com. And just said Lewandowski is operating on his own for himself, sending out press releases that he is running the vetting of the operation to pick a VP. And that's just not going on. And I'm just going to be careful what I say, and I'm just going to let Stone talk on air. But a divided House, a divided campaign team is going to lose the election for Trump. And a lot of people are concerned about this. And Trump doesn't like to have people kind of coming under the radar on him in a big operation and then sit there and make a big issue out of it. But you can also, from other sources as well, look for the finance head he's brought in, formerly with Goldman Sachs, to be out the door pretty soon, reportedly. Little bird told me, not Roger Stone, another little bird. But people are, well, this is inside baseball. Why do we care? This is what's really going on with Trump. And a lot of good things are happening, too. But I talked to Stone on record about the misrepresentations that are going on. Trump said, we're not vetting anybody coming in from these Muslim countries. They're not even making sure their passports are real. And so until that's done, maybe short, maybe long, until they go back and do their jobs at customs, and until Obama, you know, removes this order, we need to shut it all down. That turned into he hates all the Muslims and doesn't want any of them here. No, I mean, in national polls in Europe, it's 25 to 35% in France and England and Scotland and Ireland and places that say they want to suicide bomb and kill people and kill all the Christians. I mean, they have actual national polls where they poll the Muslims, and 25 to 35%, it varies in there, you can look them up, say they want to kill everybody who doesn't submit to them. And then we've got all these videos all over Europe, and this happened to my crew as well, where you'll have a whole group of young men come up with their big beards, the whole nine yards, and if you're just European, period, they say, get out of here and start attacking you. And the police are so politically correct, they let you do it. And by the way, these guys, I got to tell you, the Brits have courage to go out and march knowing the police won't protect them. But they're really lucky they're not doing that in some place, let's say, where I grew up in Dallas, Texas. Because if you slighted a little skinny white guy or a little skinny black guy, they would jump out of their car at a red light and say, let's go right now, and they meant it. Now, Austin isn't so much like that. I don't even know if this is Texas, and maybe it's a good thing that people aren't very aggressive. You know, at one level, it's good to not be, you know, really a feral, wild person, but thank God I'm wild. Man, somebody like that comes up and hits me, I am going to punch them as hard as I can and defend myself. And these guys just, they you can tell why they want to put bags over women's heads and torture people and do all this unchivalrous garbage, because they are the biggest group of wimps I have ever seen in every video. Now, I get they're crazy and blow themselves up and stuff, but man, I'm just tired of it. I am really tired. Everybody knows I was against the Iraq war. I was against all this garbage because there are a lot of good people over there. It's true. They're either like really cool and really smart and really informed and hardworking good people, or they're a bunch of crazy loons. And what happens is the way Islam's operating now, it allows bullying stupid weirdos to get in big groups and run around trying to basically henpeck and enforce and bully everyone because they have the moral authority. That's why the political correct socialists love them. It's all about henpecking and getting in your face and making you feel guilty and making you follow political correct, you know, garbage that's just like Sharia law. It's all the same thing. So I don't have it out. I have all these Muslims call in and send me emails going, you used to not be anti-Muslim. You used to, you know, tell the truth about all this. I always tell the truth. I study history. I study sociology, anthropology, geopolitics, cultures, religion. I mean, I've do my homework. And Muslims' biggest threat is other Muslims killing them. Muslim countries are the most dangerous places in the world. They're the most unstable. And the globalists go in there and stir up that beehive and put in the more radical groups to keep you deindustrialized in squalor. Europeans had a 400, 500-year period of the Dark Ages. And you can, even Lord Monckton, who's a great historian, talks about a golden age of Islam, where it wasn't like this, and it wasn't oppressing women like this, and actually helped bring a lot of knowledge back into the world. I mean, that's really history. But Islam today, folks, is really scary and really out of control, and it's on the streets of Austin, Texas. I'll tell you, my big wake-up call is you go downtown any day, and I mean, every fourth or fifth woman's got a full face covered up. And I went to Barton Creek Mall, as I said last week, to take my daughters to dinner and a movie. And my son was there, but the point was my daughters. And I just really felt threatened with these women wearing hoods over their heads, and the men were kind of gangsterish but in separate groups. And just the whole demeanor, you know what gangsterish, you know, garbage is. You know, I've been in a small town at a drive-in hamburger place. There's some weird trashy rednecks there, and they're kind of sliming around making comments. What you looking at, you know, punk? And I've been around, you know, thuggy, seedy black people that act like that. And I've been around, every group has that. And man, you're looking at these groups of Muslim men, and they look wild-eyed, crazy, aggressive, and nuts. And the man in me gets charged up. I'll tell you right now, the man in me doesn't like it. The man in me says, like Ben Grimm from Fantastic Four, it's clobbering time. And I'm just being honest with people. I'm freaked out about it. And I realize how evil the globalists are to not bring in all the Muslims that are trying to flee. The folks that want to come here and be professors and engineers and, I mean, really smart people. They're bringing the trash, the Wahhabi bottom of the barrel. The people Saudi Arabia doesn't want, like Cuba dumped all their criminals and people on us in the early 80s. Remember that? They created a stereotype of Cubans as criminals. Professional Cubans I know are really nice, cool, smart, neat people. But let me tell you, some of the Cubans that came in the 80s were absolutely horrible people. The worst criminals. Not just political rejects. Some of those came over. And that's who Fidel Castro dumped on us. And it's the same thing out of the Middle East and other areas. I don't care if they're white Chechens or Arabic, you know, Muslims or Chechen Muslims. They are all in this crazed Charlie Manson cult, bulging eyeballs, looking for a fight, all feeding into each other, radicalizing, getting more and more extreme, more and more out of control. And I'll quote Barry Goldwater. Extremism in defense of liberty is no vice. I'm not extreme. 5 million of these people brought into Europe, the rejects of Saudi Arabia, who they sent into Syria. And Saudi Arabia won't take them back. Saudi Arabia won't take one Muslim from outside their country as a resident. They'll let you in for the Hajj to spend your money on your pilgrimage. You got to do it at least once in your life. But they don't let one of these radicals they help create in. This is their spawn, their demon spawn. They lay eggs and they hatch out and they fly off like locusts into our countries. And the globalists just open their arms and say, please come in, because they're going to let them engage in terror attacks, you name it, and then tell us we have to submit to them, the political correctness, and they'll stop bombing us. And that's what all the mayor of London and all these Muslims say. Stop putting down Muslims or it's going to get violent. Submit to us. You know what? I'm not going to submit to you. The globalist engineered 9/11 with Saudi Arabia to create this clash of civilizations. Now we're into part two of it. I was against going over there and stirring up the hornet's nest, but now that it's stirred up, we're going to have to deal with it. You know, I really should just come into the start of the broadcast 20-something minutes ago and listed what was coming up today, but I go off down this jag dealing with the radical Muslims being brought into our countries. It just shows you where the globalists are doing and where they're taking us. Everything they do is about destabilization, balkanization, and a society degenerating. And they are empowering the most monotheistic, ultra-chauvinistic, to the level of women being slaves. And the Huffington Post is out promoting that other women who aren't Muslims should wear bags over their heads to show how cool it is, because they're culturally open. I mean, I'm getting fed up here. And then people go, well, Mother Mary sometimes might have worn something over her face. What would you do to her? Yeah, women in the Middle East, in the desert, out in the sun, would cover a lot of their faces up. But it doesn't mean that they would have their genitals cut off, or they'd have acid thrown on their faces, or they'd be sold into sex slavery if they didn't wear it over their head. So the beautiful reasons why these women love wearing the hijab. But that's not even what I'm talking about with their faces seen. I mean the full burkas. I'm seeing women all over Austin in the full burkas. Nameless, faceless. Anyways, I'm not going to get into this anymore. I'm going to talk more about it with Stone. My point is Trump, supposedly in the meeting with Ryan, his arch enemy, who said he won't endorse him. Paul Ryan, who says he wants the Republican war chest for himself and Priebus to basically keep, not to give to Trump to win, in there openly sabotaging Trump and the American people. They say, you know, Trump said that, oh, that was only a suggestion. And then Trump was questioned. He said, well, it is a suggestion. If they're not going to vet it, we got to do something. And they're spinning it like he backed off his position. He did no such thing. He said, until we start doing something about it, until we start at least making sure these passports are real. Hey, did you know the United States bans everybody in the world already except Muslims who don't have a proper passport? Supposedly flying into airports, if you don't have one, you don't get in from China or Japan or South Africa or anywhere but a few places like Mexico. They let folks come in with no ID from Mexico, and the Border Patrol, quote, completes the smuggling process. Remember the Border Patrol agents on this show, the union heads, and on Fox News saying, yes, we were told we'd be fired if we told you. We could be indicted if we told you for violating national security. But we're ordered to bring them in and give them vouchers and ship adults and children into the United States to Democrat facilities, basically. Churches and other groups getting federal money. It's totally illegal. It's the government flooding us with illegals. Well, unskilled illegals and kids are a drain on us, but at least they're not jihadis. Now they're bringing jihadis in, and this is why this is so important. Almost all of military-age men. It shows the whole war on terror is a hoax. It's designed to get worse, to take more of our liberties, but never keep us safe. Just like Benjamin Franklin said, those that will give up liberty, for security, deserve and will get neither. You don't deserve freedom if you'll give it up. And by the way, you're not going to be safe under tyranny. Remember, Eisenhower famously said in a Columbia speech, you can pull it up and type in President Eisenhower speech on security. He said, I can make you secure. I can lock you all up in prison cells. But then you'll be a prisoner. And I'll go one further. Prisons, you can get more drugs and more whatever there than anywhere else in most prisons. So it's all an illusion. It's all a fraud. It's all garbage. It's all bull. And I've had enough of it. Now that said, here is the biggest news of the day. And Kit Daniels brought it to me this morning. It's on Infowars.com. Been up for about an hour. About 30 minutes before showtime, he brought it to me. Buckley, during the break, said, hey, my cousin, smart guy, one of the guys that helped me start Infowars 21 years ago, he said, why aren't you covering Kit Daniels' article? Did you read that? And I said, yeah, I read it. And he goes, it's incredible. It makes perfect sense. Don't you see it? And I said, yeah, I see it. And I said, it's so big, I don't even know how to properly address it. Well, when we come back from break, we're going to do it. The story is on Infowars.com. Zika outbreak at Rio Olympics could ignite global martial law. And that's exactly what it is. It's a global martial law drill. The whole thing is hype. I mean, the pathogen's real. But the whole thing's engineered, and I've predicted this in Endgame. I predicted this countless times as one of the global outbreaks they're going to use to beta test global response, global control. And it's perfect how it pops up right where they're having the Olympics so they can then turn all the airports and everything into a police state, including much of the United States. They say Texas is going to be as bad as Brazil. Texas border towns brace for Zika outbreak. I had family ask me why I still go to Mexico sometimes, and I said, you know, they said, Zika. And I said, hey, Zika's already here for months. We've got Mike Norris, filmmaker, martial arts master, patriot, joining us with Gary Haven, also the patriot, pilot, multi-billionaire, founded a whole bunch of big companies until he sold it, the most successful gym franchise in the world, Curves. Big anti-New World Order patriot, popular guest on this show, fellow Texan, fellow Austinite. They're both going to be in studio. They were on Fox and Friends this morning, Coast to Coast AM, last week. They have been doing serious touring to promote the film Amerageddon. And they are going to be in studio with us for an hour and a half today, coming up at the start of the next hour, ahead of Roger Stone, the Trump insider, joining us with all the latest on campaign 2016. The trailer for the film is on Infowars.com. Braveheart and the Establishment Republicans is a new article that Gary Haben has written. And you can go there and see the trailer as well. But it's very important where it opens in theaters in Texas in just a few days that it sell out, just like America 2016 did and others, so that this film, and I think it costs like $7, $8, $9 million, I forget. It's a pretty good budget. This film gets out everywhere because most people get their news and information from films and from entertainment, not from the news, as we talk about. And they're going to be joining us because the film's got a bunch of big stars in it. I'm in it. And I'm not bragging when I say this, but I've turned down being in some really big movies. And I've been in films with Keanu Reeves and Robert Downey Jr. and Winona Ryder and Woody Harrelson and others. I mean, I've been in Scanner Darkly. I've been in Waking Life. Quite frankly, I've been in about 10 other big films and dozens of others. I don't even go watch them. I don't even remember the names. People want to use clips of the show or want me to voice something. And it's something I agree with, the position. Then I will be part of it. Would somebody come destroy this fire alarm in here? Thanks. Somebody pull the fire alarm in the building. By law, I got to have it even in the studio. The globalists are coming. The globalists have opened the borders. The New World Order is taking over. Run to the hills. Yeah, I might just get a ladder over here and take it out for me. Thank you. But hey, it'll make good radio for folks, or I can go over there. I can probably throw something at it, throw a laptop at it or something, and just break it out of the ceiling. All right, I think I'll take it out. But There is a lot. You can just physically remove it, guys, is what I'm asking. I'm just up here like Napoleon commanding armies that don't exist. But to get serious here, before I get into this huge Zika virus news and information, it's so important. If you look at the different pieces of it, if you look at the different angles of it, it's extremely, extremely, extremely revealing. We're going to cover that here in just a moment. And that is the fire alarm, I guess. Imperial troops have entered the base. Imperial troops have entered the base. But I'm going to cover it here in just a moment. Can I walk and chew bubble gum? Yes. Can I do a radio show during a fire alarm? Yes. I remember at Bilderberg in 2008, Obama was coming. Hillary was there. They disappeared for over a day. It's the day before, and they have the head of security, before they kick us out of the hotel, come up and threaten me. He said, I will kill you. And then someone else came up and said, you better not try to pull the fire alarm and steal things. I thought, that's weird. So I go back to go on Coast to Coast AM and do a nightly update. I did like 4 or 5 nights a week at Bilderberg. This time it was in Chantilly, Virginia. And as soon as I go on Coast to Coast AM live, they pull the fire alarm. Make everybody go outside. They had all these foreign secret service groups going through the building. Well, I stayed in the building to see what was going on. Obviously, I was creeping around. And then finally came outside. And boy, security was so mad at that point. And even before all of that happened, I saw men out front. I still smoked cigarettes occasionally when I was nervous, maybe 2 or 3 a day. I was smoking cigarettes at like 11 at night. Coast Coast was coming on like an hour. And I heard these engineers and technicians going, yeah, we're going to test it. Yeah, we're going to test it coming up. Then they're going to do the sweep. So they were already going to do a fire alarm drill. They just decided to somehow have security claim I was doing it. So there I was as a good detective just picking up all the info. Heard them talking about testing a fire alarm. Didn't put 2 and 2 together. Then 10 minutes before they do it, they say, you better not do a fire alarm. Try to steal stuff, Jones. And then they still pulled the fire alarm and tried to blame me. But that's the fire alarm story. And it's on video, by the way, in my film, The Obama Deception. You can see it all unfold and see it all happen. But the issue is, back then, they would let me stay until the day before the event. And they throw everybody out. Now, we try to go to these hotels a week before. There's video of that in England a few years ago in Watford, or 2 or 3 days before in one case. And we are thrown out. We can't even get 2 miles away at a restaurant or a pub. They've ordered them not to let us in. The managers come over and say, Jones, get out of here. You're not welcome here. And I'll say, oh, Bilderberg told you? And they said, absolutely, they did. Now get out of here before I call the police. So it is just simply amazing to see that type of stuff go on. But I'm sure that was just something else they can tell me during the break. Is all good? The building's not on fire, is it? Okay, good. All right, just an airplane crashed the building. I'm joking. All right, I've got earth-shattering stuff to cover. Let me just regroup here and get into this right now. Most radio shows would just cut to a video or cut to commercial or something, but I don't do that. I think we turn that into an interesting story. I want to get into Obamacare double-digit increases threaten Democrats. I thought it was free. Okay, whatever. But I was just a racist conspiracy theorist that actually read the bill. Sorry. We're also going to get into Saudi's brace for release of hidden pages of 9/11 report. We'll also get into $1.91 trillion. Government collects record high taxes in first 7 months of fiscal year 2016. And the big story, Zika outbreak at Rio Olympics could ignite global martial law. But before I do that, speaking of Zika and things like that, colloidal silver. I did have a bottle of it in here, but I took it home with me yesterday. Even though I have plenty of bottles of it at home, I don't know why. Like a little monkey, I took it away. Will somebody bring me a bottle, please? Thank you. And I was in the creek with my kids, as I said 3 days ago, got some gravel in my eye, it kind of scratched it, and the next morning it was just pounding and aching and really, really hurt bad. But I still came in and did the show, and then it kind of got infected. And I thought, why not put colloidal silver in it? It took me a day to think, hey, it's one of the most powerful antibiotics out there on record. 30 parts per million is seen as safe. You can go smaller, but we live at 30 parts per million. Thank you so much. She's brought it into me. And within an hour, of me putting it in, 80% of the pain went away. By last night, like 98% of the pain went away, and most of the redness went away, and it was like blood red, you know, Dracula eyes yesterday, and it's just almost gone. And I didn't have to use an antibiotic. I did go get an antibiotic, but by the time I went to the doctor yesterday and got an antibiotic, I didn't need it. I said, I'm going to hold back and keep using this, and it worked. So I did have a cut on my eye. I did get an infection from the creek, and the colloidal silver, I believe, knocked it out. So that's four times colloidal silver's work like a charm. One time on my cut-infected leg, it did not work. But I guess that's because I couldn't get it enough internally in to the wound. But I was taking it orally as well. So I guess it did fail that time. So it's not perfect. It's not a silver bullet, but it's as darn close to it as you're going to get. So they call, you know, something that takes down evil, silver bullet. 30 parts per million made by the biggest lab in the United States, the highest quality. And this is the very same stuff you see private labeled at Whole Foods, but we sell it for less than they do. It's that simple. It's a big bottle of it, 2 ounces, and a lot of folks take it all the time. There was a guy famously pulled a stunt and drank, you know, like 5 million times what you would safely. I mean, literally just gallons of pure stuff, way stronger, to turn his nose blue as a stunt. And so they could, you know, then demonize it. Because, you know, something like this, Big Pharma obviously doesn't like it. Listen, I'll take antibiotics if they work. A lot of times they don't now. You know, I get sick. I go out and get sunshine. I try to eat more vitamin C. I try to get healthy. But colloidal silver is simply amazing. This is something every emergency cabinet needs. By the way, speaking of emergency, we are seeing mainstream media admit that the elite are prepping. Governments are digging in with storable food, armored vehicles, weapons, you name it. I don't know what's coming. There's a lot of crises out there, but I want to be prepared. I hope nothing happens bad. But we need to be prepared. Government has bunkers full of food. They say you're bad if you have it. But now they're saying actually have a week, have a month, get prepared. You know, tax exemptions on survival goods from the feds and the states now because they want to be able to say, no, we told you get ready. So they've gone from saying don't prep, it's kooky and evil, to you should prep. But everyone knows society is untenable, that anything could cause a bottleneck event. That is common sense for anyone that's informed. Humans are experts at controlling our environment. And we've built this new artificial environment that's great in many ways, but also one of the most dangerous things we face. And anybody is 18 hours from the other side of the world today with things like Zika, you name it. I personally have gotten a bunch of storable food put in, medical supplies, and more generators here at the office. And they're like, oh, that's a doomsday cult. Really, the police department has that. The fire department has that. The city council has that. They have deals with backup generators to run key city systems. Oh, if it's impossible, it's going to happen. Why do they do that? Oh, it's normal when they do and build giant secret bunkers and railways everywhere. They admit they built them, but the details are classified. But if I want to have enough food for every crew member here for at least 1 month as supplemental, if things were to collapse, that I could try to take care of some of the crew and keep operating here, doesn't mean we have all the answers. But we've tried to harden this facility at least a little bit, harden the doors, have concealed carry people that are working here, have former military police type people, let's just leave it at that, working here for basic security. I mean, obviously, we're somewhat of a target. Not a big target. I mean, drive down the highway is 100 times more dangerous, than working at InfoWars. But the point is, we're not just rolling over. Humans get prepared. Ants get prepared. Grasshoppers don't. They freeze to death. So it's like having an umbrella in your car. You know, you got it there when you need it. 40% off the four top-selling four-week, three-month, six-month, one-year food supplies at InfoWarsSelect.com or InfoWarsStore.com. We'll take you there. And Vitamin Mineral Fusion is back in stock. It is an amazing amalgamation of the top minerals you need, the vitamins, the amino acids to upload it. Totally natural, absolutely delicious. Flavored with xylitol, but it has very little of that in there because the natural minerals and vitamins in it, like B12, just already tastes so good. Pure B12 tastes wonderful, like our Secret 12. But that's now available. Great way to get yourself off Coca-Cola or other soft drinks. Great way to get your kids off sugar drinks. My children have been on this for a few months, and they weren't really fat. One of them had a few extra pounds on them, and they've lost a lot of that. Now this is what they drink instead of sugar drinks. That spoils my kids a little bit. I don't give them a bunch of sugar drinks, but this has less calories than orange juice. And one of my daughters loves to drink orange juice, so do I. But I've gone to this and lost a few more pounds as well. So it's available. When you purchase it, it funds the operation. It's really a high-quality product, Vitamineral Fusion, from InfoWarsLife.com. Okay, I'm going to stop right there now and really get to the big news. Sorry we got interrupted by the fire alarm, but that was kind of apropos of the warnings we're raising here. Zika outbreak at Rio Olympics could ignite global martial law. And I read the article and it clicked. Wow. Why hadn't I seen this earlier? Why haven't I talked about it? I mean, I've had some guests on about Zika being patented by the Rockefellers back in the 1950s. If you don't believe me, just type in Rockefeller Brothers Foundation, Zika virus patented from Africa and then genetically manipulated. I mean, you can actually type that in and you'll go right to the Centers for Disease Control patents section. But we've done reports on it. It's on InfoWars.com. And I started reading this and it really clicked. I mentioned, wow, this is a bad idea. One of the worst Zika outbreak areas. You've got people from all over the world coming there. 300,000, 400,000 people, they're estimating, maybe more. 100,000 extra workers. So let's say 500,000 extra people. Some estimates are higher. Now, will you Google the estimates of how many people are going to attend the Summer Olympics? I think that's a low number I put out. Maybe 3 million? I've seen different numbers, but we'll see if my memory serves. It's around the country, so it's in different areas, but 500,000 here, 500,000 there, 300,000 here. It's a big event. People from all over the world coming in, the biggest of events, really, isn't it? And then now they're going to fly out. Well, how do you counter that? Testing people, checking people at borders. So they don't check the borders for real diseases like hepatitis and all this other garbage and HIV and drug-resistant bacteria. No, 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 no. We don't test now. They did on Ellis Island, but not now. And they admit those diseases are pouring across. But with Zika, they're going to respond. And magically, with genetically engineered mosquitoes that have already been released by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation down in South America, but also in the U.S., magically now this mutated Zika is showing up right on time for the Olympics and a great beta test of having a global governance response to this and coordinating. Zika outbreak at Rio Olympics could ignite global martial law. Now, listen to this Obama executive order. Are the elite intentionally using the Olympics to spread Zika worldwide? Question mark. Which, of course, attacks fertility, causes deformed children. So a lot of women are saying they're going to hold off on having kids now for several years. You see? You see? And then, oh, worse Zika comes. See, the children of men. No more children. Zika, which was... is a souped-up bioweapon, according to a top expert, could spread to thousands of international tourists visiting upcoming Rio de Janeiro Olympics and lead to martial law scenarios across the world. Zika is rapidly spreading throughout Rio de Janeiro, with scientists baffled by this new, different, vastly more dangerous. Oh, how magical. You put out mutated mosquitoes to supposedly counter it, and then it got worse. Oh. Just like you put out pesticides and the bugs get more resistant, or bacteria get more resistant to antibiotics, or viruses get more resistant, but that's okay. Sure, this isn't happening, even though it has happened. With scientists baffled by this, quote, new, different, and vastly more dangerous, close quote, strain that's overwhelming the Brazilian military's efforts to contain the disease, yet both the International Olympic Committee and the World Health Organization are severely downplaying the risk of Zika. But President Obama has seemingly prepared for such an outbreak by signing an executive order to apprehend Americans who merely show signs of respiratory illness. In particular, Obama's order allows for the detainment of Americans who display severe acute respiratory syndromes, which are diseases that are associated with fever and signs and symptoms of pneumonia or other respiratory illnesses, are capable of being transmitted from person to person. And when we come back, I'll go over all of it straight ahead. But the perfect time, the perfect place for a global crisis. We've got the makers stopped into a church of a pretty darn powerful film. I'm surprised how cinematic, how well it's been done. I mean, I go see these giant $100 million, $200 million films that aren't as good. The new film is Armageddon. I'm in it. And again, I wasn't bragging earlier when I said that I've been offered to be in a lot of films, but I end up just saying no and not doing it. And then I segued off when the fire alarm went off and never finished why I was telling that part of the story. I wasn't bragging, hey, I've turned out a bunch of Hollywood films. I meant to go on to say, but I did this one because it's an important message. But people think like being in movies is just like end of the world cool. And it really isn't. And most of the Hollywood folks aren't happy. And all the cool Hollywood people are patriots and end up moving to Texas or Tennessee or somewhere outside of L.A. I mean, I'm just telling you that people think of it as the promised land and all these young women go there and, you know, end up just being prostitutes, basically, because there aren't jobs there. It's the place where dreams die. But we're trying to basically not take over Hollywood, but with all these films we're promoting, like the Behold a Pale Horse film and others, and Amerigeddon, it's because they can really have an effect to wake people up and warn them about globalism and America being taken over, and about the globalists using an EMP strike to bring us to our knees, and other serious issues. It's a powerful film. But we are going to get some Chuck Norris questions in. You know, Chuck Norris has been on the show years ago, 4 or 5 times. He is a listener, a daily listener. He's a very humble guy. Doesn't look like he's, you know, 77 or 76 or whatever it is. He does live right here in Texas, obviously. His son's here. And, boy, he's seen it all. The stories he can tell about Steve McQueen are amazing. You're talking about a ride a motorcycle, Mike Norris. But really, it's about the courage of Gary Haven to put the money behind this and to be in the film as well when he understands how big a threat this country's under and how big a threat people that resist it are under. Believe me, you get threatened making films like this. The establishment doesn't like it. People don't like it when people like Dave Mustaine come on and criticize Obama. They go after his record contract and they try to cancel his shows and boycott him when he does. You say, well, the people don't care. Yeah, but the record companies do. They punish people that speak out. But more and more people are speaking out regardless, and it's having a big effect. So that's why I'm so excited. They're going to be joining us. But getting back to Zika, which Dr. Francis Boyle, top bioweapons expert, says has a lot of evidence that it is a souped-up bioweapon, has now spreading basically all over this hemisphere, right up into Texas. And it's showing up and now getting more and more hardcore, more and more weaponized. I mean, whether it was weaponized or not, it all points towards that. It is weaponized in that it's getting much worse, much more communicable, and it appears is from saliva and sex now, from person to person, not mosquitoes. Mosquitoes are the original vector. They are the original vector. But now you've got the target vector being the Olympics, so this can be spread all over the world, human to human, 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 chain reaction. The virus is mutating and getting stronger and getting worse. That's not a good thing. So I've been sitting back hoping this wasn't a bioweapon, but Dr. Boyle and a lot of other top experts say that all the evidence points towards it. I think it's time to get Dr. Boyle on ASAP to go over this article, and because this is a great article by Kit Daniels. He links to some of the scientists and other articles, but this needs to be looked at by scientists like Boyle, who helped author bioweapons treaties and more. He's actually the author. So we'll be back with the second hour. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com. We're just watchmen on the wall here, trying to get the word out so that we can maintain our liberties. Amerigeddon, with the globalist engineer, a global crisis or a national crisis to bring in control. Well, they're already doing that on many fronts. But an even more devilish plan is clearly being developed, and this is a fiction film that parallels real-world events and near-future possible events. We're going to be playing trailers from it, giving you the website, going over it, and more. Now, other news that we're going to be getting to, obviously, is where the economy's going. We have the federal government raising $1.91 trillion. Government collects record high taxes in first 7 months of fiscal year 2016. Despite collecting record revenues, government still runs a $354 billion deficit for this year alone. Meanwhile, is there any body that doesn't understand this is being done by design? Is there anybody out there that doesn't understand? and get it through their head that this was maneuvered into place to make us dependent. This is the globalist program. They admit this in countless textbooks, countless political theorems, like Cloward and Piven's just one that's better known. Not even really what they've implemented, but it's a similar system. That was just a proposal to bankrupt things to make us all dependent and totally crash the system. Now, this is out of an article in the International Business Times. Dow Jones Industrial Average tumbles as Disney and Macy's shares lead rout in consumer stock sector. And again, is that any shock to anyone with this headline on a Breitbart? Obamacare double-digit increase threatens Democrats. That's why they tried to keep pushing it back, pushing it back. Obama didn't want any of the increases that are in the bill to start until 2016. But the way it's written, insurance companies could start it in 2014. They did. So the average premium went up about 60%. Then it doubled by last year. Now it's set to go up even more. My insurance close to doubled. My father's and mother's doubled. They'd barely even use theirs with the same insurer for 35 years. My dad was so incensed. And over a year, it went up in like 3 months, 20-30%. Then a couple months later, 20-30%. Then 20-30%. It was like 97% in 1 year. And then the next year, it went up. So he's shopping around, and you've got to wait for what windows you can go buy it now. Used to, you could just get insurance anytime you wanted to. They're teaching you to have things rationed. They're teaching you to stand in lines. And what did the White House, Rahm Emanuel's brother, one of the authors of it, what did he say on Fox News a few years ago? He said, of course it's meant to bankrupt healthcare. And when it's bankrupt, we're going to go to a single-payer national healthcare system. That's it. Administered, though, by a few mega insurance companies that are left standing. This is all written to consolidate the market, let them rip everybody off, ration care, the giant screw job, galactic level. And, man, the first year, I don't really go to medical doctors a lot. I go to them some to have blood work done every few years or get a checkup. But when I'm sick or something, I go to a clinic, nice little clinic, close to my parents' house that I've been going to for years, probably 15 years. And I go there to see a nurse practitioner or a doctor. And, man, I'd sit there and wait an hour and watch these people coming in. And, man, they had insurance, but they were mainly minorities. It was women, black women, Hispanic women, white women. And they would say, excuse me, I have insurance. It's double. They would go, ma'am, it's the Affordable Care Act. Here's the, and they give them a piece of paper. And it was just the prescriptions, everything. They would turn around and go, oh. And I'd say, you thought it was going to make prices go down? They'd go, yes, we were lied to. And I'd be at Barton Springs, and all these liberals would run up that were a couple of years ago, whenever it kicked in, that were lifeguards. They got like 15 lifeguards at one time. They'd go, Alex, we apologize. We all just got cut to halftime because of Obamacare. You warned us. We didn't believe you. We thought it would give us free health care. It's not free. And I said, I know it's not free. I'm sorry. You just got ripped off real bad.
The reason I'm here today is to encourage the U.S. Congress to take action to protect our country from its most imminent threat. Electricity would cease, the internet would go down, and the banking system.
The smokescreen of national security used by government at every level.
A strong America is the only thing standing in the way. Country only needs a little chaos.
We have a fog that has descended on our entire nation.
Hello, Mr. President. Now is the time.
The average American family only has 3 days of food.
We need to talk face to face. This is important.
Sir, what's the mission?
Disarm the population and restore order.
Do you have any weapons inside your home or on your person?
You had to give the president power to arrest any American by simply accusing them of terrorism.
The vanity of nationalism will quickly fade. These are but the birth pangs of a new world order.
I'm just so afraid of the world that you're going to have to grow up in.
This is a time, man, woman, young or old, when folks run and hide, or they pull up their bootstraps and they fight.
When you sell your soul, it's a one-time thing. There's no going back.
Amerageddonthemovie.com, and it's about to be in theaters. And if it's a big hit in theaters here in Texas and other areas, it will go nationwide. And I tell you, I've seen $150 million, $200 million movies like Captain America that are almost unwatchable, and the acting isn't even as half as good as what you guys have put together here today. Mike Norris, a director, Gary Haven, writer and producer, and also stars as one of the Patriot leaders in the film. I'm also in the film with a lot of other amazing people. And again, I wasn't bragging earlier when I said I turned down being in Hollywood films. I mean, I just am not in them because I'm actually fighting the globalist, and I don't want to just be in movies for no reason unless they have a good message. And Hollywood's messages are almost universally bad. But I tell you, I saw this script and I said, I am incredibly honored that you guys put me in the film. And I came in there only like a day or so of the script, and you guys put up with me and did a great job. And just congratulations. You guys were on Fox and Friends this morning, I guess right after Donald Trump and with his daily visit. And that top-rated show, you've been on Coast to Coast AM. You've really been busting your butts. Gary Haven is a billionaire, folks. He started some of the biggest companies in history, the most popular training gym for not just women, but period in the world, Curves, before he sold it. And so it's just great to see somebody giving back to the community. I know Mr. Haven doesn't brag about it, but behind the scenes, he also gives a lot of money to defend the Second Amendment, property rights. He had one of these billionaires that just gives money for his interest because he's basically retired. He gives money. And I know he's not going to want me to say this because some of this is inside baseball. He's one of the biggest donors out there. He's going to get harassed now by folks who want money to actual issue-based things that defend the republic. And if more wealthy men and women would actually just not do things for their own interest but for all of our interests, we would be in a free country. So he spent a lot of money. This is a pretty big budget film. For an independent film, he made it right here in Texas and other areas, not in Hollywood. We're very proud of Mr. Haven. We're very proud of Mike Norris. And, you know, he's got great exploits in his own right in films and TV and acting and TV shows he's produced. But he's also the son of the guy that when he does push-ups, the earth moves. And, of course, daily listener, I want to say hi to him. Chuck Norris, another fellow Texan, because he's from Oklahoma, which used to be North Texas before they turned it into another state. So that's North Texas, actually, North Texans. But good to have both of you here, Gary and Mike. Congratulations, gentlemen. It is so wonderful to have you with us for the next hour and a half.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Alex. And I tell you, what a great introduction. I want to thank you for being willing to come and participate in our movie. You know, what you're going to see when you come see Armageddon, which opens, by the way, in theaters tomorrow, is you're going to see Alex play the evil senator. We had to tell him, Alex, you got to tone it down a little bit. You're too evil.
a little too good.
Like Dr. Evil on the program. But we've made a great movie that's going to make a difference. Armageddon is about dealing with two issues. One is the most imminent threat that we have in America today. And that's according to the Congress. There were two congressional studies on electromagnetic pulse attacks. And I tell you, the movie is so timely because go back to February 7th, and North Korea launched another satellite. And North Korea, we know, has miniaturized nuclear weapons. And we know, according to Kim Jong-un, that he wants to destroy this country. So
he says he wants to EMP us. And my concern is, even if he didn't do it, the globalists could false flag it and blame it on him.
Yeah. Yeah. Russia and China, who we have antagonized, are partners with North Korea. They share technology. So if Putin has enough of American aggression, of American imperialism.
Oh, he could use Kim Jong-un, the crazy man, as the delivery system.
That's right. And Kim Jong-un will be in a nice condo, a penthouse condo in Beijing, and could care less about his people. I mean, we know this crazy guy. So we were warning people.
He is handsome, though.
Oh, yeah. The haircut and, a little bit of weight, issue.
He's a quintessential government thug nobody that couldn't even bench press 5 pounds, can hardly walk, just literally feeding on his people with a bunch of sycophantic communists.
Yeah, and so we've given the power to this person to destroy America. I was talking to Dr. Peter Pry, who's the leading expert on EMP. In fact, he's with Homeland Security. I was speaking with him yesterday. And I asked him, I said, what are the chances that North Korea has a nuclear weapon on that satellite that crosses the United States twice a day? And he said, very likely it exists. And this is Homeland Security's expert on EMP.
We know there's a lot of weaponized satellites that our government, the Russians, the Chinese have put in. What if one malfunctions and comes into orbit? That's why they never wanted to send some of those space probes out that were nuclear powered, because if they failed going into orbit and came back in, it could create an EMP event. But separately, the film itself is obviously trying to get folks to be aware of EMP and get Congress to move on that, and actually parallels real legislation, because for, as you say, a few billion dollars, we could shield the country by putting surge protectors, basically, in giant surge protectors. But you expose how the globalists are behind this and the UN, and so it really educates people about how world government openly states that they want to come into power through global crises, be it Zika, be it the Islamic invasion, be it EMP. I mean, I knew the film would be good, but it is excellent. And I just can't wait till it's, you know, gone to theaters, DVD, Blu-ray, and then television. I know I'm putting the cart before the horse, but Mike, what was it like working on this film? I know you're proud of it. Tell folks where it's going to be opening, how important it is to come see it.
No, yeah, it. This film was it was really interesting because it was, you know, when Gary wrote the script, it was a challenge. This film was actually a challenge to make. We had plenty of resources, but the scope and the size of the film that we were trying to create in the time frame it worked out perfect. And where we're playing, what was the second question? I forgot all about it. Well, I'm sitting here listening to you guys.
Explain to people how important this rollout is. Also, you told me privately before you were on air, and then the first time ever back in November of last year, you said, no, I had a bad feeling about Cruz. I don't like him. I've flown around on the jets with him. He wants me to finance him. I asked him some questions. It's private. I'm not going to get into it. But I don't like him. And I remember you saying that. You said it on air. You told me a little bit, you know, behind the scenes, but then you've kind of outed him in the last few months, and a lot of people said that that helped finally push it over the edge, and a few days after you, quote, outed him and went on big syndicated shows, I apologize, I had a family emergency when you came in here, but you were with Knight, that you helped, along with others, torpedo Cruz. So we're going to talk about that a little bit later. Also, your dad coming out about geoengineering, mm-hmm. chemtrails, super huge in WorldNet Daily, so a lot of big things to talk about. I'm sorry, we got to talk about the world of Chuck Norris. And Mike loves that world, too. But this film is so important. So let's talk about how we get behind this film, how Texans and others, where this is first opening, are critical in getting this out nationwide and reaching hundreds of millions.
You know, and that's what's really great. And thanks to you and the alternative media. What's happened is a groundswell has been created through social media. Through YouTube, we've had 4 million hits on YouTube. We've had 17 million unique views on our Facebook page. So it's really the patriots of the country that are coming together and joining together as one to go out and support this film. So this has been an amazing ride to see how people actually come together as patriots to go support this film. Now, We're starting out, we were only going to go into about 20 theaters starting off. And in the last week, we've had added 10 more theaters, but we had about 50 more requests for theaters.
And by the way, that's what happened with 2016. It was only coming out in like 4 or 5. Mm-hmm. Then they wanted 20. Mm-hmm. Then they wanted 100. And then it went to 2,000. I mean, you're the expert on this, but correct me if I'm wrong. I've studied this and I follow the trade publications, Variety and things. It looks like you're lifting off the launch pad with a good moonshot here. It looks like if folks sell these out and fill these theaters up, it's going to go nationwide.
Absolutely. We are 100% prepared on Monday. If we could just reach our projections this weekend, come Monday, we're ready to expand nationwide. Not a problem.
And then it's going to be a hit.
Thank you. Thanks to Gary.
Hey, Gary, incredible. I mean, really, it takes a lot to it's easy to talk about it, but to do it. And then to star in it and to pull it off. But I guess to be, you know, a top salesman from Texas that made millions of dollars, you know, you could have taken an acting job and just didn't pay enough. So you've taken a pay cut here.
You know, obviously I didn't do it for the money.
Oh, I know.
You know, and why did we do it? Well, we wanted to warn people. But the other thing, and you brought this up, is that there's a criminal elite in Washington, D.C. who are bought and paid for. These people are controlling our country. You can call it the shadow government, to the deep state.
And Americans know that, and they're ready to hear it, but no one will reflect their view. Sorry.
Well, the Donald Trump movement is what this is about.
We're going to skip this break. I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir. I'm interrupting you too much.
The American people have realized, they've awakened that our country has been stolen. And here's Donald Trump raising up and saying, I'm going to lead the move to take our country back. That's why Donald Trump is resonating.
There's all these populist waves coming in. And sure, you've been a patriot for 30, 40 years. You've been brought up one. Mm-hmm. We're kind of old timers at this. But isn't it exciting to see our ideas, our understanding being validated and proven. Fluoride really is bad for your brain. Hey, there really is a world government. Hey, you know, there really is an Illuminati. Hey, they really are establishing Sharia law in areas of Europe. Everything we've warned people about, global governance, the attack on the family, 9/11 and our government working with the Saudis, it's all coming out.
It's amazing. We live.
Please continue. I'm ranting. It's just the points you make are so good.
And I'm tempted to, too, because I'm so excited.
Do it. Do it. Go wild.
I'm so excited about this. You know, you missed vaccines and you missed military-industrial complex. I mean,
everything. Yeah.
The corporatists have bought and paid for this country. You know, this Trans-Pacific Partnership. And that was part of how I outed Cruz. Any of our politicians, and many of them, and I'm a big former Republican donor, the Republicans signed into the law the fast-tracking of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And what you need to know about that is, number one, is any of our politicians that thought the TPP was a good idea are traitors to this country. That law trade agreement takes away the sovereignty of nations and states and gives it over to a tribunal of corporate attorneys who all they have to do is determine that a corporation has been harmed financially from the act of a
government. We got proven right about corporate world government. Here it is. And they call it global government. And the Pope calls it world government. What do you think is happening? I mean, 100 years from now, what will they call this time in history?
Well, they're either going to call it the Great Awakening or the Great Disaster. You know, I am definitely afraid that they're going to kill Trump. Trump is such a threat to the power and the wealth of these people that are owned by the elitist, that I don't know how, you know, you're familiar with MK Ultra mind control.
You know,
I'm terrified they're going to have one of these guys come in and knock him out. And Mike and I were talking about this today. Will the American people really rise up and take their country back? I don't know. You know, you cut the head off of something, it usually dies. And I think they know that. And if they'll kill a sitting president, John F. Kennedy, what will they do to simply...
I agree. A, you know a lot of people. Do you know Trump, A? And then B, from knowing folks that do know him and being a fellow, you know, successful billionaire, what is your gut reaction? What do you think of Trump? Me personally, there's no way all this elitist hatred is a fake or a shill to make us think he's good when he isn't. I mean, they think he's coming in to take over something, their quarry, something they've already taken over, something they're reveling in dominating, and Trump's coming in with nationalism and things that even if he wasn't for real, what he's saying is sunshine to vampires. What's your view?
Well, I haven't met Trump personally, but I just received my third invitation to be on his advisory committee. That's a small group of people.
Oh, wow, great.
And I didn't want to accept that because I felt like it would kind of bias me towards him while we're trying to focus on the movie. And also, I had to talk about Cruz objectively. When I was on your program, I first outed Cruz back in November.
Even before Trump was on the radar. We didn't discuss him.
Yeah, you know, I was invited to dinner with Cruz, and I saw it as an opportunity to...
You were first here in 2014. Wow.
Yeah. And Cruz was somebody I was actually excited about. I thought, oh, man, here's a Christian. Here's a guy that... He's a constitutionalist. And when I had dinner with him, he began
to... Do me a favor. Go all the way, because you went further at dinner a few times. I mean, yeah, tell us everything you can.
Okay, so we're at dinner at the governor's mansion. Governor Abbott set me beside him, which was kind of cool, about six of us. And Trump, Cruz began to pontificate about the Ukraine. His version of it was that Putin's a bad guy. Putin went into Crimea and was raping and pillaging and the Ukraine. And after I listened to this for about 10 minutes, I just couldn't be quiet about it. I said, Senator, look, there's a whole other version of this. You know that Victoria Nuland, who worked for the State Department for Hillary Clinton, was caught talking about spending $6 billion to overthrow the elected government of Ukraine. And you know that the central bankers... put the central banker in charge of running the government right away.
And this is all on video. She said this on C-SPAN.
This is all fact. And so I'm explaining this version of it. The governor's kind of looking at me. It was getting a little hot. And I turned to the governor. I said, you know, you going to invite me back?
Wow, Cruz was getting mad, yeah.
And he was, because I had the facts. You know, Putin didn't go into Crimea and overrun that country. The Crimeans had a referendum, and 94% of them said, no, we want to go with Russia.
Because they're traditionally Russia. And look, I'm not defending Russia. It's done some bad things to Ukraine, vice versa. But the country's always been split. But the West initiated. George Soros bragged that he engineered it. Well, this guy's our mortal enemy.
And look at the government in place right now. They're made up of neo-Nazis. These guys have swastikas.
And it's the same elite that want a civil war here.
Yep. And so who's behind this? Well, the central banks are behind it because that's how they acquire the assets of a country, just like Greece. Goldman Sachs created the Greece mess so they could turn worthless cash into hard assets like the airports and the and electrical grid. Well, you also have Monsanto. They have been trying to get GMO seeds into Europe. Well, Ukraine is the breadbasket of Europe. So Monsanto wanted us in there. Then, of course, you have the military-industrial complex, which wants a war because they profit off of war.
They're kicking the door down to Russia, and Russia's got its own problems. But these are globalists trying to use American muscle to start a war with Russia, and it's crazy.
You know, Cruz told me at the end of the dinner that he said, you know, I'm not a neocon. And I kind of looked stunned, and I was thinking, well, of course you're a neocon. You're trying to get our kids into Ukraine. You're trying to get them to Syria. You're a warmonger. So I went and researched Cruz. And then I find out, of course, that his wife's a VP for Goldman Sachs. She's a member of the Council of Foreign Relations, specifically the committee to eliminate borders in the U.S. Through the North American
Trans-Pacific Partnership ties into the North American Union Agreements.
North American Union Agreement. And then, of course, we find out a few months ago that Cruz didn't report a loan he got from Goldman Sachs and Citibank of $1 million for his campaign. So he's bought and paid for by the bankers. He's bought and paid for by military industrial. Then he voted for the TPP fast track. So he's bought and paid for by the corporatists. And then you look at his own website, look at his advisors. Two of them are former CIA directors. And the others are bankers. This guy is an insider's insider.
He came in here as a Bush sleeper cell because they knew their name was dead.
Yep.
And he is the fourth Bush administration attempt.
Well, you know what the elites have done is they create the illusion of choice. So we can choose either of their two candidates that are bought and paid for. Cruz was the designated opponent, and he was set up for that purpose. And the reason he lost so badly is the American people began to wake up over these last few months.
Well, especially when he kept saying Trump supporters are the violent ones, when it was a bunch of George Soros, literal kill the cop people, beating up men, women, and children, and we got the footage. I want to say InfoWarriors, our listeners, our viewers got the footage, but my crew, all that great crew back there, had the courage to go get that footage, and that helped push it over the edge, you exposing. And we're not bragging here. It's saying we have power. The people can resist. We can say no to the evil. God is helping us. And you know, notice here's Gary Haven. Obviously, he didn't make this movie to make money. He put all his money into the movie as a labor of love. And then now here he is not even promoting the movie, just wanting to expose the globalist because he's got such passion for it. And by the way, Mike Norris is an amazingly humble man, but boy, is he smart behind the scenes at dinner or around the office about things when he gets to ranting. I tell you, he's got that fire in the belly. I wish Mike Norris would tell us what he really thinks about everything. He's being very polite right now.
You know, it's interesting. There's a segment of the population that is on the fence that could go one way or the other. They hear the information and they're trying to process it. For a long time, that was me. I was very much into the Second Amendment, the Constitution. These are things that my dad brought me up believing. Second Amendment, the Constitution. But once you start peeling back the onion, the more you start learning. And with my relationship with Gary and just the conversations we have listening to your show, you know, I've now realized on my own that there are nefarious things happening behind the scenes. And it's scary. And it's a perfect timing for Armageddon to come out right now, just the way the climate of the country is and just the Trump movement has just really brought the, like I said, the patriots to a boil.
I feel providence in the air.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I really feel blessed to be part of this project because, you know, this was Gary's project. This was Gary's passion project, something that he knew very well. He understood very well. And I came into it as a filmmaker.
Stay there. Let's come back and talk more about it with the director. Mike Norris, AmerigeddonTheMovie.com. Check out the trailer. It's got 4 million views.
power grid was wiped out, who would be in the best position to survive? In a new movie hitting theaters tomorrow, the audience is faced with that question, and ultimately, what happens when your government turns against you?
Well, let's hope it doesn't, but in the movies it does. Mike Norris is the director of this new movie, Amerigeddon. Did I say that right? And the son of Chuck Norris. He teamed up with producer Gary Haven to make an ultimate political thriller. Welcome, guys.
Good morning.
Thank you. Thank you. It's good to be here.
Gary, where did this idea come from?
Where
did the idea come from?
Well, you know, we've been looking for a way to make a difference in society. And movies that entertain while they teach was a great medium. Because, you know, people will watch a movie. And this idea was one of the important things, because an EMP attack on America is the number one threat to the survival of this country. And this is according to two congressional EMP committees. And so we wanted to wake people up and also demand that our government do something to protect us.
Okay.
All right, folks, that's just one of the clips when they were on Fox and Friends this morning. There's several other clips I want to play. You can see HD clips of the film on the website, AmerigeddonTheMovie.com. I'm going right back to these gentlemen here in just a moment. In the next 30 minutes of the first hour, we're going to open the phones up for your questions for Gary Haven or Mike Norris. But AmerigeddonTheMovie.com, you can find out where it's showing in Texas and other areas, and then where it's going to be expanding out. But it opens tomorrow. It opens tomorrow. And so before I plug here, let's do some plugging for the film, because it's important. You put a lot of money into this. Mike Norris, it's linked on the website, but off the top of your head, where are the cities where people can see this first?
Well, the movie actually opens tonight. The theaters decided to start it on Thursday night.
Oh, wow. So it's got that hype going.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, so and all the signs.
All the signs. So we got Phoenix, Denver.
There it is. Oklahoma.
Oklahoma.
In Tulsa, Oklahoma City, Tennessee, Nashville, Texas, Austin, Dallas. It's got all the theaters, all those big theaters there. Wow, yeah. It's already opening a lot.
Yeah, so we're Phoenix to Grand Houston. Rapids, Michigan.
Yeah, also Las Vegas and Denver.
Okay, see, I'm ignorant, and because I'm so busy, you're busy. I mean, last time I heard it was the plan 2-3 months ago. It was just going to open in Texas first. Now suddenly it's opening already all over the country. This is exciting.
It's very exciting. It's very exciting. Personally, I've never, it's been since I was a director on Walker that I've been involved in anything that has really had such legs as something like
that. Can I touch you? I mean, I'm not like that. I mean, no. I mean, Walker, Texas Ranger, the greatest intentional, unintentional comedy in the galaxy.
No, absolutely. And
so much of it's good. I love it. My parents watch it every night. They actually put the dog ears on, so they can watch it on broadcast TV. Yeah. It's also on cable. It is so, it's entertaining. It's funny. It's got good moral stories. Mm-hmm. It's just awesome.
But, it was...
With Trendies, that's like the hottest thing, right? I mean, you understand that, they worship Walker, Texas Ranger.
Oh, that's funny. But, we knew early on that we were onto something really special. My dad was very methodical and very smart about the direction of Walker, Texas Ranger. It's the same way with Gary and myself on Amerigeddon. This has been a very methodical process that we knew the only way we could achieve success on this film was by the Patriot community, the people that are awake and that are going to go out to support this, and the people that are going to bring their friends that they think need, hey, this is something you need to see. I was thinking about something the other day. We went and saw Captain America. I love that movie. I love Captain America.
I like part two better, but yeah.
Yeah. And I was thinking, wow, Captain America is a great movie.
Winter Soldier was great.
Yeah. But then again, I thought, you know what? Amerigeddon's a great movie that could save your life.
I'll be honest. I think Amerigeddon's better than the new Captain America. I mean, it has false flags. It actually has some good messages in it. It's like watching a woman beat up 50 guys. Yeah. It's just not real. I mean, I know it's fantasy anyways, but man, it's kind of over. This is plausible, what this film you've made.
Yeah, but it's very deliberately plausible. We didn't want to wash it out with the stuff that makes movies over the top. We wanted it to be all fact-based, and everything in this movie
it's more Escape from New York style. And when I said Walker, Texas Ranger had the intentional, unintentional comedy, it's funny, it's fast-paced, it's action-packed, it's got great actors in it, but it's got also kind of that, you know, Snake Plissken kind of, where there's parts that are kind of funny.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, those are things that really were kind of, accidental. It's just, good actors on the set, and we'd rehearse it, and something funny may come up, and we just shoot it, and in the editing process, it works, so we used it. And there's nothing wrong with adding a little humor to all this. When the world's falling apart, it's good to have a little laugh every now and again.
Absolutely, and your dad all deadpan, it makes it even funnier, but it's just amazing. My kids love it still. Now, I'm sorry, I'm interrupting. Let's put that back on screen for TV viewers so I can read this out for radio listeners, because there's some folks that aren't on the internet right now. I want to be able to tell them where it's showing. Let's go through all the places. Arizona. It's showing in Phoenix at a whole bunch of theaters. Wow. Let's scroll down. Colorado, Denver. And as you scroll down, continuing, Michigan, Grand Rapids. And then as you scroll down, Nevada, Las Vegas, North Carolina, it's in Charlotte, Oklahoma, Oklahoma City, it's in Tulsa, it's in Tennessee, in Nashville, it's in Texas, it's in Austin, it's in Dallas, it's in Houston, a bunch of theaters in Texas, Lubbock, San Antonio, Waco. And folks, you talk about voting with your dollars. I talk about this all the time. You buy organic, it displaces the bad garbage just because people can't sell it. It's the final vote you've got in a tyranny is voting with your choices, voting with your feet. And the grassroots opening of a film like this, and there's already big hype behind it that just naturally happened because it's viral, because it's so good. This could be on 2,000 screens within a week or two, couldn't it?
Absolutely. Absolutely. We are prepared week two to go into 200 screens, not a problem. We've already identified the markets that...
That's how it works. It comes out like 20, 30, 40, 50, mm-hmm. 200, 1,000, 2,000.
Yeah. But, it's also important that, I don't take Gary's investment lightly. When he commits his resources to this as a director and as a producer, I take it very seriously.
I've been on a lot of sets. I mean, I've been in some movies and TV and stuff. And I'm telling you, your crews were focused, professional. You were on target. You were basically on time. It was amazing.
Good old Texas crews. Can't beat a Texas crew.
More about the film, more about why it's so important. Our audience is educated, but for other people, they need to see it. This could be their first introduction to globalism and how they're taking over our country. Perfect timing for Trump. I think Trump boosts the film. I think the film boosts Trump, Gary.
Yeah, this timing is so perfect. There's an awakening, a great awakening in this country right now where people realize it's been stolen from us. We have no rights. There was a study done by Princeton and Northwestern published last year where they looked at federal policy from 1981 to 2003, and they determined that all federal policy was determined by the moneyed interest and that you and I as voters have no influence. Washington is bought and paid for. And I'm not just talking about the socialist, communist Democrats. I'm talking about the establishment Republicans, and people are waking up, and Trump is leading that. He doesn't say Hillary's name without saying the criminal Hillary. He doesn't say Ted's name without saying a lying.
No one has ever done this. It's beautiful.
This guy is so courageous. And again, I really haven't officially come out for him, but let's face it. We have the chance, and this is what's so important. Let's quit talking about policies. It's a waste of time. Let's talk about who owns our country and what we can do to take it
back. He says globalism has taken us over. It's the enemy. It's bad deals. And look, I don't want to speak for Chuck Norris. I don't want to say anything. We talked a year ago about this. I know you like Trump, and I know your dad speaks for himself at WorldNet Daily. But I tell you, are we going to hear from Chuck Norris about who he likes for president?
I really think I could not speak for my dad on this, but I think my father, whoever the Republican nominee is, my dad will support.
Sure. Well, I always keep secrets, and I'm a good boy. I want to get your dad back on. I haven't bugged him in a few years. I know he's semi-retired, but I tell you, we need Chuck Norris on the scene like Delta Force, throwing some flying sidekicks here.
Absolutely. I want to see it. My kids want to see it. It's interesting because...
Oh, we need a Trump ad where Chuck Norris does a flying kick into a robot Hillary and knocks her head off. Not the literal Hillary, but, a robot Hillary covering up Benghazi. And, on the phone saying, order a stand down. I want them all dead. No witnesses. And Chuck Norris goes, no. And then kicks the robot hand off when she's, pulling the lever to kill the SEALs.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, there we go. Sorry.
Don't bet your dad's supporting the movie.
Oh, yeah. You know, it was interesting because, you know, it was important to me. You know, first off, I don't take being Chuck Norris's son lightly at all. My dad has worked very hard to create a name and a legacy for himself. And the last thing I would ever want to do is...
No, you don't speak for your dad, yeah.
But there's a responsibility with me also as his son, as Mike Norris. Now, I am my own man, but...
But he is proud of you.
Absolutely.
He's proud of this film.
Yeah, absolutely. He loved the movie. But it's a serious thing. I do not take being a Norse lightly. And with that, I take what I do very seriously. And the Amerigeddon is by far the most serious film I've ever been involved in.
And your dad's Second Amendment.
Yeah. And it's like we were talking about earlier, you know, I was raised to believe in the Constitution and the Second Amendment. And those are things I know that are near and dear to my dad's heart. And even now, I see my dad expanding his horizons a little bit. I saw something on WorldNet Daily about chemtrails with my father.
Here's the article. He got it right, though. He didn't, because I always use the word chemtrail. That's the vernacular of the public. Exclusive, sky criminals. Chuck Norris examines geoengineering in the skies above us. And then he linked to mainstream government admitting they're doing it, but they call it geoengineering, then they call us kooks when we first discovered it and, you know, call it chemtrailing. But it's not all planes. It's not just ice crystals. There's a secret program. The pilots aren't involved. It's added to jet fuel. We have the patents. And here is Chuck Norris coming out. I mean, that is amazing.
You think maybe he could be vice president?
I don't know. Now, would your dad be vice president with Trump?
Nah, Chuck Norris is the president.
That's right. Okay. Oh, my gosh. Seriously, though, the break interrupted us. Gary was getting Gary Haven here, one of the producers on the film, successful billionaire businessman from Texas, fighting the globalists, trying to keep the Republican Party on the straight and narrow, which has been a hard job. He's here fighting back through media where the real fight goes on. AmerigeddonTheMovie.com. It starts tonight. At midnight in some theaters around the country. Find out more at AmerigeddonTheMovie.com or on Infowars.com. We have the trailers and links to all of it. But you were getting into Ted Cruz, and you were talking about, when I said, what do you think of Ted Cruz? Because I liked him. You know, we've interviewed him once, but I knew his pedigree was Bush, but I was hoping he was real. I liked his, you know, record in the Senate, which I guess was a beard for his real ambitions. He said, not good. Very, very, get a bad vibe. And, you know, he's kind of neocon globalist and, I'm not going to tell you all the stuff, but it's not good. And, you know, I'm concerned he's connected to the Bushes and Goldman Sachs. And this was like a year and a half ago. This was in November of 2013. We have a clip of this. In fact, we'll put it on screen from YouTube, and I'll try to give you the exact date. But here you are like a year and a half ago or longer. This is almost 2 years ago when you were first on, when you were just about to make the film and were inviting me to come and be part of it that now is premiering tonight and tomorrow. But let's go ahead and play that clip where... Gary Haven basically first sounded the alarm in a very gentlemanly way about Ted Cruz.
Ted Cruz, like the guy, but I vetted him and I don't trust him. I believe that he's given himself over to the elite, to the establishment. And in fact, you know, we can't go into all that, but the only guy I've got any hope for right now is Rand Paul. And I've met Rand Paul. I've talked to Rand Paul.
Tell me about, I mean, I know him as well. I've known him for 20 years. Tell me... but I haven't talked to him in years. Tell me what you got from meeting with him.
I'll tell you two things. The first thing is that I'm convinced he's the son of his father. And I'm a big fan of his
father. That's why they hate him. They know he's for real.
Yeah. But the other thing is he's also smart and he's staying in the middle to stay electable.
And they know he's doing that.
So I believe that if he gets elected by staying in the middle, that he'll be the son of his father when he's in power.
And that's exactly what...
Oh, that's enough right there.
The Atlantic and the New York...
I want to say great job of the crew. They found the second time you were on,
the first time you said it privately, but also some on air from the year before that. But there you are before anybody was saying that. And of course, there's more stuff that went on behind the scenes. You don't want to, you know, put it all out here. But you basically told me the first time we met that you were being nice on air saying I liked the guy. But didn't you kind of tell me at dinner the first time we met in 2014 he kind of creeped you out?
Well, you know, if...
You want to be a nice guy. I get it.
Yeah, you know, but let's face it, he everybody you talk to, he kind of gives you the creeps. He looks like
Dracula.
Grandpa and the Addams Family. but anyway, you know,
plus he got mad at you when you argued with him. I
mean, yeah, because he's not used to being challenged. You know, I was on the Jim Baker Show Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday of this week. Millions of people heard me talk about it. And Jim Baker was thought it was important enough because the Christians had been deceived by Ted Cruz. And I've got a lot of Christians that are mad at me for talking out about Ted Cruz. Well, you know, truth is the truth. And I was really hopeful that we had one of us running for office.
You got to go with your gut, go with your spirit.
And if you look at Cruz's charity donations between 2005 and 2012, he gave away under 1%. And he didn't give anything to any church. So those Christians out there that would be mad at me for criticizing Cruz, hey, guys, look, I don't like it either, but you've got to look at the evidence. And the evidence is that, you know, he doesn't tithe. He doesn't really give anything to charities.
Faith without works is dead.
There you go. Now, so it is what it is. And fortunately, he's now relegated to the back burner. Although, you know, you hear him rambling about making a comeback now. It was on your website yesterday.
Yeah, no, he said it on radio shows and stuff. I said the whole time he's going to double back. Look, we have Stone coming on later. They are still planning. He has it in their meetings. He has moles. Yeah. They're planning to still try to put Paul Ryan in there, too. I mean, they're doing it.
Well, you know, we spoke about if they kill Trump, you know.
That's it.
You know.
Oh, man, this is so obvious.
Absolutely into place. So our talking the truth about Cruz may have a bigger impact than we can ever imagine. Now, I pray for Trump and that he's protected, and he is our only hope standing against these globalists that want, you know, Henry Kissinger said that a strong America is the only thing standing in the way of a new world order.
That's right. But he said if Los Angeles collapsed into total riots and the country was in revolution, then we would welcome UN peacekeepers.
And he said that you control oil, you control the nations, you control food, you control the people.
And he also called our military dumb animals.
Yeah.
Cowardly sack of garbage.
You know, and this is in the public domain. But of course, the mainstream media is bought and paid for. As everybody knows, the six major medias in this country are 95% are owned by six.
And they're globalists, they're enemies of this country. Gary Haven, and of course, we have Mike Norris with us. The website's AmeriGettingTheMovie.com. I'm Alex Jones with InfoWars.com. We'll be back. Your calls are coming up in the next hour. We got more clips we're going to play. We are back live, ladies and gentlemen. AmeriGettingTheMovie.com. The toll-free number, if you have a question or comment for Mike Norris or Gary Haven, is 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. Quick comment or question. All I ask is your phone be good. You'll have good connection. And by the way, we don't screen your topics. We don't care what you bring up as long as it's addressed to the guest. Speaking of an information war, you are financing an information war when you fund this broadcast. And we try to bring you the best products, the best non-GMO seeds, the best Hillary for Prison apparel or Molon Labe apparel, the very best nutraceuticals like X2 or Vitamin Mineral Fusion Fruit Punch, multivitamin system to really help yourself, your children, and others. The best durable foods with 40% off right now on our four top-selling groups at InfoWarsStore.com. And look, this is stuff everybody needs. And so I go out and find the very best products I can that I personally use myself or that we develop ourselves to win-win, and then I bring them to you at a very low price. And a lot of marketers go, you know, you should just charge more. People have a perception that they're getting something better. And I'm just like, I'm not doing it. I'm going to give them, look, I'm going to have 100% markup. That takes that to fund this operation. But I'm not going to do 4, 5 times, 6 times markups are the average in nutraceuticals. And then they put crap in it. You know, where the bottle costs more than what's in it. We don't do that. We don't do that. I mean, in many of my products, 40 to 50% of the cost is actually what's in it. It's unprecedented. It's super high quality. Survival Shield X2, you name it. It's all available. InfoWarsLife.com takes you directly to the nutraceutical page of InfoWarsStore.com. But there are thousands of great items. We go out and also find the top rated, you know, jumper cable mini battery system for your car. And then we buy a bunch of those and sell it lower than Amazon. I mean, I'm an aggressive capitalist. Whether it's DNA Force or Brain Force or Secret 12 or Knockout, Great Sleep Aid, Totally Natural, it's all available at InfoWarsStore.com. Super Male Vitality sold out, but Anthroplex is basically the dry formula of that, joint and bone formula. And you're funding through your free will, through your purchase, absolute tip of the spear in the fight against tyranny, because the information, the analysis, the talking points we put out get picked up by everybody else now because our angle on reality is so accurate because we're going off the globalist white papers, not off their disinfo on mainstream media. I'm not that smart. I learned how to actually read UN treaties and read UN plans and read Ford Foundation plans. And man, it's spelled out. That's why we're able to tell you what's coming next. And now folks are listening. You know, that's the good news. We'll start the next hour here in a moment. But that's the good news, gentlemen, is that people, I think, really are waking up. Global government's out in the open. They always had to get to that point. Where do you think we are? Where do you think it's going? And if this was a football game, what's the score right now?
And that's a good question. We're certainly in the fourth inning. You asked a question earlier that let's kind of go back over. What are they going to say about this period of time a couple hundred years from now? And it's going to be either the Great Awakening where we took our country back from the moneyed interest, from the greed, the power, lusting for power. You know, the people like Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton and even the Bushes, we either take it back or we lose it. And 200 years from now, this is going to be a moment in history. So we are certainly in the fourth quarter. And I tell you, I was kind of hopeless, Alex. I'd pretty much given up on the American people waking up and really thinking critically. You know,
trying to work through the system. You finally took action yourself. Now you're kicking butt.
Yeah, that's right. You know, I was a major Republican donor, hoping that I could raise people to power that actually were conservatives, you know, that believed in the Constitution and the free market.
The truth is you just took the gloves off and you're doing it yourself. That's what it's all about. You're a modern David. Both of you stay right there. We're going to be back in just a moment. Absolutely, Gary. We are going to be taking questions here coming up in the next segment. Gary Haben is our guest. He is the producer, one of the main stars, the brainchild behind the hit film. And I'm saying hit because one trailer has 4 million views. The other has like 2 million. There's about 6 or 7 other derivatives of it. I'd say 10 million views on the trailer. That's good for a big film. You know, the budget. What was the budget?
It's a secret.
Well, let's just say
it was a lot.
You spent a lot of money, buddy. You put your money where your mouth was. Yeah. So congratulations to both of you.
Thanks, Alex.
And you spent a couple years getting this together, and it's starting out in theaters tonight and tomorrow in many areas of the country. Phone calls 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231 are coming up in the next segment. But Mike Norris is doing it again. Incredible points during the breaks, animated like a public speaker. And then he's great on air, but he's more humble. Give us the real Norris. Go ahead.
No, I mean, we were talking off the air about, you know, when my father was coming up in the late 70s, early 80s. As a kid, I got to witness what I think is the greatest American action star ever.
True Americana.
I witnessed it. I got to see it and be part of that vortex and just watch my dad. But it was on Walker that we knew we were onto something special that was a game changer for us. And
you got that same feeling again with America.
And now all of a sudden,
old TV America, franchise.
I'm not the billionaire.
Does the evil politician come back?
Yeah, but it's so, you know, I'm very fortunate to have, you know, be in this position to have something that has the opportunity of success. Not many films. There's 27 films opening this weekend throughout the country. 27 films. So I understand that people are going to have to make a conscious decision, maybe have to drive past two or three theaters to come see our film. And I just want to say to everybody right now, you know, thank you. And we appreciate your support. This could not happen without you.
Oh, I do too. People say, thank me, all the time on the street or on air, and I go, stop it. You're the lifeblood. You're the patriots. We wouldn't have a platform. We're all brothers and sisters together that love liberty, love God, love our republic, and we're doing our best to not start a shooting war. We're trying to fix things peaceful while we gear up to defend our families. If this is life and death, folks, we're with you. We get it. We should be doing this. I want to say Gary is a hero for his courage, so is Mike Norris, but quite frankly, at the end of the day, you told me, you said, look, I'm doing my duty. I mean, this, you know, you've told me I'm not a hero. Look, I mean, what am I supposed to do, leave the country?
You got a good memory. I said that over a year ago. We've had death threats come in. We aren't taking them seriously, although we are armed at all times.
What do you got in that top pocket? That little baby one right there.
Well, you know, it's accessible. You know, another theme to the movie, Alex, that's so important is preparation. We not only show what happens when our country turns on us and allows this EMP to happen. Okay.
Get them out on the table.
Wait a minute. Are we?
People say, hey, you can have more high-tech weapons. No, this is only the first line because you can count on it in a fix and it's readily available. And then we got even bigger ones here. But
wait, hold on.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir.
Well, for those that are not watching on the internet, we each held our guns up to see which one was the biggest.
Yours is probably bigger in reality. I got a bigger gun, though.
Alex, I'm looking at your gun.
Now we're turning to Donald Trump.
I'm looking at your gun, and it's a big gun.
Hands are okay.
Your gun's bigger than my gun.
Okay. We're going to break. Let's come back, though. The long segment, go to calls. Let's actually talk about the death threats, talk about what people have gone through, but also the type of control. Well, what happens in Hollywood, Mike Norris, when we come back, second him? What happens when you do just basic pro-family, pro-male, pro-female, pro-God films? They try to block you out. But the good news is Christians and others are going and supporting independent films, and they're getting bigger budgets, they're getting better, and we're voting with our feet and our dollars, and we're starting to defeat Hollywood, and Hollywood is starting to collapse. Mike Norris, Gary Haven, the film, Amerigeddon, starting in select theaters tonight. Only you can make it a hit and educate people about the global menace. I'm Alex Jones. And now people are starting to listen. The spirit of liberty is rising, as the Bible says. I forget what verse. Can you guys look it up? That when the enemy comes in like a flood, the spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against it. And I'm telling you, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against it. It is so exciting. It is so beautiful. I'll quote Mark Twain. In the beginning, a patriot is a scarce man, hated, feared, and scorned. But in time, when his cause succeeds, the timid join him, because then it costs nothing to be a patriot. And that's why Mike Norris, for decades, promoting liberty, freedom, the Bill of Rights, Constitution, his father for decades and decades, Mr. Haven doing it for decades and decades, and now things are so dire. All these humble men that didn't want to be on air, that didn't want to be in movies, that didn't want to be in, that tried to do things behind the scenes, they're being forced to stand up. And that is the sign that the sleeping giant is rising. Here's the quote, Isaiah 59:19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. You hear that? So they shall fear the name of the Lord from the west. The west rising. And the glory from the rising of the sun, when the enemy shall come in like a flood. It's only then that the spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against them. And men, you're humble, but everybody needs to know, the men and women out there watching and listening, all of us together, we are that standard. And we need to be humble. None of us are perfect. We don't claim to be, the perfect, but our souls are pointed towards God. Is that an accurate statement?
Oh, I'm totally sold out for Jesus Christ. He's my Lord and Savior. I got no problem saying that.
Me neither.
Yeah, Alex, we knew that the alternative media would support this project because we're all passionate for truth. You know that the Christian community has embraced this movie. For example, I was on American Family Radio this morning, about an hour ago. Also, Jim Baker, the great evangelist, who, by the way, I've come to know, he's an amazing guy, had me on the last.
That's why they went after him. And the really corrupt ones, they leave alone.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Cause, he was the founder of TPL. He was the founder of 700 Club. He's an amazing guy. But they've embraced us. We believe that a lot of Christians are coming to this movie because they know truth when they hear it. And as reluctant as they may be to face the evidence that our nation is not here to help you, they're willing to look at the truth. And they're willing to dare to embrace the evidence and even consider taking their country back. In Amerigeddon, the movie, that's the second purpose, to warn people about the imminent threat, but just as importantly, to awaken people that our country's been stolen and we can take it back.
So this is a Paul Revere alarm. Now, you were making some key points when we went to break, both of you were, about the pressure, the demonization. Hollywood, admittedly, is collapsing, but people still aren't basically aware of that, but more and more folks are just tuning out, and it's creating new media. Can you briefly speak to that? Because Amerigeddon is clearly about the liberty movement now joining the success of Christian films that in some cases are bigger than Hollywood drivel.
Yeah, I think, what? The industry is changing, and it really goes back once again to the audience, the believers, the patriots that are willing to get up and go support these films. But it was very apparent that we were persona non grata in Hollywood very early on in this process. When the trailer came out, my brother Eric, he's one of the biggest
stuff. I know you don't want to get into it because it's private, but let's just, there were a lot of stuff behind the scenes, a lot of pressure. I don't know how much you can now say, but I mean, all hell broke loose once they found out what was happening.
Yeah, they were trying to shut us out in any way possible.
Drive up prices.
Yeah, but you know, even with the MPAA.
But Gary just doubled down.
Yeah, sorry, yeah, he did. But it was like just getting a rating. They gave us an R rating for this movie. We have no custom.
Oh, Hollywood folks won't even come and change a light bulb here at my office because of what we do.
Yeah.
They tell us, no, we like you, but we'll be blackballed if we do any work at your studio.
Yeah, and that's pretty much what I've been told. Don't even worry about coming back to Hollywood to work.
And by the way, they gave us the R rating, but we fought and went back because it was ridiculous that we'd have an R rating. You know, how do you create a disaster film without a little blood? And so we simply went back.
They did it to scare Christians off as a deliberate manipulation.
And Mike fought for it and got a PG-13 rating. So it's not R, it's PG-13.
Yeah.
So, you know, it is for
adults. You know, John Wayne movies deserve an R rating. You know, The Sands of Iwo Jima, if this is an R. That is a load of manure.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. So
they don't want it on Lifetime. They don't want it on TV. That's what they're scared of, is the life of this on TV.
Yeah, but it's going there. It'll go there. We now have distribution through Entertainment One, and Sony is picking up our DVD and VOD rights. So, you know, but once again, it goes back to our the people that are here supporting us, the patriots that are, you know, answering.
It's a culture war. We're fighting back, and we're winning.
Absolutely.
And I tell you, it ticket sells, money talks in this industry. And God's Not Dead is a great example. You know, it was a pretty good movie, but people went to see it because they liked the message and they enjoyed it. And that's kind of the trick on this thing. You can get support, but if you don't make a good movie that's entertaining, you know, people aren't going to come, and that money's not going to talk. But our movie is entertaining and it has a purpose. And Hollywood is respectful of those things. And that's how we ended up with Sony Pictures as our distributor for the ancillary market. So we're, you know, with the help of the audience, the 4 million people that have watched the trailer.
Even the establishment knows a winner when they see it.
Yep. And we're going to take advantage of the popularity of this theme in having made a good movie, and maybe even make inroads into, who knows, we might actually show the movie in Los Angeles one day.
Well, I got to tell you, gentlemen, something. I can feel the energy in this. When I get excited about something, my audience gets excited. I it's a spiritual thing. I don't want to brag, but we've all got discernment. You know, I've got extreme discernment. And not just what you're doing, it's everybody's putting in their two cents to fight the tyranny. And together, it is huge. And I can feel the spirit of liberty rising. I can also feel evil rising. It's such a critical time for all good people to be involved. Mm-hmm. All that evil men need to flourish is that good men and women do nothing, to quote Thomas Jefferson. And Gary Haven, Mike Norris, you're just getting to know you guys. You're just such good, regular, decent Americans. And to see you countering the anti-human, anti-family garbage. And look, I've been around. I'm not some, you know, little kid. Hollywood acts like, oh, you're just a square. You can't handle what we're doing. No, it's not that I hate people or groups. You're selling an agenda to hurt people and to break up families and to make us weak and to make people disdain God's greatest gifts. And so that's why I get angry at Hollywood and the establishment, because they're trying to rob us of our birthright. And to see you guys and your crew fight upstream, and to now, it looks like, as you can see the numbers, successfully launch Armageddon. It's an American success story. It's a human success story. It's biblical in nature. And so I shake your hand, but I want to shake Mike's too. We're going to take a few calls. But, gentlemen, I am proud to be associated with you and what you're doing. It feels good in my soul.
Thank you, Alex. And we really appreciate what you do every day. You're on the front lines and have been for many, many years. And I'm glad you're packing, because if somebody wants to retaliate on you, it's not going to be an assassination. It's going to be a gunfight.
Damn right. Excuse me, Lord. Yeah, absolutely. Look, I'm not afraid of dying, but I need to be there for my kids. And I'm just trusting in God. And my problem is I get out in crowds and people, and I just totally, there's no fear. And I've just actually been praying to God, can you get me to be a little more, I don't know what happens, just like I'm on this mission and it just, I'm not bragging. It's weird, actually. I wish I had fear. It's almost like, where are the nerve endings? Where is it?
Well, you know, we've all kind of been around now long enough to learn to trust the protection that comes.
So I guess that's it. It's the comfort.
Yeah, we're protected. And I tell you what, you can't be about God's business and be obedient if you're allowed to be fearful of the enemy. And, you know, the Bible says that
it's good that I'm not afraid. It's just sometimes I wonder, gosh, you ought to worry more about it.
Yeah, I mean, you need to be smart.
I mean, as we make preparations, it's a Bedouin saying, trust in God, but tie up your camel. Yeah. And we trust in God, but we prepare also.
Yeah, and that's, you know, our movie's a lot about that. We prepare, and we encourage people. You know, you've got a great food product here that's available to people, great price. I've had some of it. You know, we need to have food in storage that will last for a time such as this.
We're going to skip this network break. This is too important. You're absolutely right. And you're not selling storable food, but you're promoting it in the film because patriots need to be prepared. The globalists want us dependent. So what should we do? Independent. So I sell the best non-GMO seeds, the widest selection, what I believe for the lowest price, the best you know, food. And look, sure, we fund ourselves with it. That's how we're here. We fund ourselves with the moral things from our research we know we need.
Yeah, you're backing up this message with you know, with a business model that allows people to acquire these things. And by the way, I've been taking your supplements now since the last time I was here. And I got to tell you, you know, I have a degree in health and nutrition.
I know that. I know you've bought some big supplement companies yourself.
Yeah, great products. And I know that you have the integrity behind all the things that you create. You wouldn't put your name on it if you didn't believe in it.
I mean, look, it's called, God, as you know, God-fearing. And the way to describe it is, it's not that I do good because I'm afraid of God. I don't even think about trying to screw people over because even thinking about it, I'm not even thinking about it, but even imagining it because you could do it, I feel totally guilty and afraid and freaked out. People say, oh, you're a wimp. Well, I guess I am. I just can't screw people over. And it's not like I'm wanting to and then feel guilty. It's like you war game stuff and even think about other people that are doing it and you just feel horrible. I'm like, how could you do this? But see, that's the difference between somebody that has a conscience and doesn't. It doesn't mean I'm perfect. It just means that I don't know. These sociopaths think we're weak because we care, and I think they're blind is what's happening. Mike?
You know what? I got to throw this one back to Gary. I'm sorry. I was just kind of enthralled in your conversation and being a spectator.
I've been really enjoying this interview today. I'm not kidding. This is like electric.
Yeah, you know, I built the largest fitness franchise in the world based on the Judeo-Christian principles, and it's real simple. Tell people the truth, honesty, do what you say, integrity. Show up to serve, which is the law of greatness. He who would be the greatest would be the servant of others. Reciprocity. If resources can flow through you to meet the needs of others, you could be given more resources. And Alex, you really have applied these Judeo-Christian principles to your business model as well. In fact, you don't want to make a sale. You want to make a difference. And that shows
up
in all the things
you do. I only sell things I know I need and I want people to have.
Yep.
And then it's like they're me. When I make a product, sometimes we can't even have product because we want to have the, and I love Dr. Group, he's like that too, it must be the best we can do. And sometimes I go, Group, if there's nothing better, we have to have this. He goes, but it's not absolutely perfect in California standard. I just go, it's the best we can do. You know, he's even worse than I am.
Nothing's good in California. I mean, they've
raised standards
in California. That's ridiculous. So.
Oh, there's more lead in the air than you're allowed to have in food.
Yeah.
It cannot be detected. And so most of our stuff passes that standard. And these top labs keep going, this is like a miracle. You keep passing all your stuff. And I'm just like, I don't know. Dr. Group sources it. I don't know how we're doing it. It's crazy. It's like, anyway, side issue. The film is Amerageddon. It is opening in some theaters tonight, more tomorrow, in at least 10 states or so. Find the states and cities it's available on the website. We'll put it back on screen. AmerageddonTheMovie.com, linked up on InfoWars.com. I'm going to tweet it out again at Real Alex Jones with the trailer. Please retweet it. Please put it on your Facebook. This is an information war. You are soldiers and captains and colonels and majors and generals and supply chiefs and intel officers, every man, woman, and child, regardless of race, color, and creed, on the ground. Now, I want to invite you guys. You've been going on almost an hour and a half. Roger Stone's coming on, but I know you guys are into politics. I also want you to tape some stuff for the news. So it'll be your choice if you want to stay and ask a few questions of Stone while he's on with me or not. But we're going to go to some calls right now. We got Tony, Nelson, Ben, Ron, Buckley, and others. Let's go ahead and talk to Nelson in Florida. You're on the air with Gary Haven and Mike here in Austin, Texas. Mike Norris with us. Go ahead. Did I go to Nelson or I go to Tony? Okay, Nelson, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering if you had plans for events after everyone sees this movie and everybody wakes up and they're looking to make a difference, if you had any events planned. If not, I have an idea. I'd
like sure, like what about like the Passion of the Christ, showing it in churches in the next wave, making community events, organizing against Agenda 21 around the film?
You know, we're having to kind of take this in steps right now.
I got it. You're overwhelmed. Getting in tears.
You know, because unintentionally, Gary became a distribution company. This is not something I set out to do, is to use his money to create a distribution company. But just because of the resistance we had in Hollywood, we had to create our own distribution company.
See, that's the biggest seller. And you guys, I get it. I'm the same way. I'll have this huge news and wait till the end to say it. If you guys put out how they tried to block you and tried to block the film, Amerageddon, the film Hollywood tried to block, that's what you put out in press. It's true.
Yeah.
But I know you don't want to get into, you know, you're gentlemen, but I say hammer them.
Yeah.
And they don't want you to see this film. They've tried to block it. Go ahead. Yeah.
But fortunately, you know, we've got a good team of people assembled, Seth Willenson, who it's really interesting because here's a guy that is liberal as can be, that is so sold out for this movie and is working tirelessly.
He believes in free speech.
Absolutely.
A liberal.
Yeah, but he is...
Real liberal.
Yeah, and but he understands the importance of this film. He understands it. So he...
Well, there are a lot of great people that are what you'd call a real liberal versus these new ones that want to ban free speech and arrest everybody and beat everybody up.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So where we're at right now is just to the point where we need to get it into the theaters and we need to create the awareness and the buzz. So
now, Nelson, that's a great idea. We're doing media and stuff right now, but we're eating an elephant one bite at a time. But that is a very important angle, I think, Gary.
Yeah, I agree.
Let's go to another caller here. Let's go ahead and talk to Ben. Ben in Missouri, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Good.
I was just wondering if you have any plans to bring the film to St. Louis. If not, I'd love to, you know, help you guys make it happen.
Is it in St. Louis right now? I think it is.
No, it's not in St. Louis yet. You know, I'd have to check and see if that's on the list. If we expand more next week, you know, definitely have to look into St. Louis. We like I said, what we've tried to do with this film is we've tried to come out to the Patriots, where the Patriots are, just through... you know, some brilliant data research somebody's doing. And so we're trying to get the film to you. So if you could call a theater, say, hey, you know what? We want this movie. We demand this movie.
That's right.
You know, that's how we added 10 theaters in 3 days.
And I want to be clear. The caller said earlier, once everybody wakes up seeing this film, we defeat them. This film will be a big punch in the overall boxing match. And it could be a big uppercut that wins it. Regardless, we're fighting. And so it's the production, it's the taking action, it's the resistance where most of the brainwashing is in the media. We're countering it with the antidote. This is like a big old antibiotic pill going in there. And so it's that overall commitment. We're not saying this film is going to save the world. Mm-hmm. Might save the power grid, though. That might save it because that goes down, we're all dead. So that's what it comes down to. But it's resistance is victory.
Yeah, you know, Alex, you brought something up. I believe that God is going to protect a remnant. And so our goal is to make this remnant as large as we possibly can be, is the more men, women, and children that we can get to prepare that allows God to preserve his people. It's kind of the goal of this thing. That's what this is about.
That's right. They want to bring us into a global crisis, bring us all to our knees, make us take their mark to get food. They admit that now.
Mm-hmm.
Not from the Bible. They're saying, getting rid of cash, digital, you're going to do what we say, or you don't get medicine, you don't get food. We better start getting to the countryside and getting self-sufficient with other Christians and patriots. Or it's game. I mean, folks, the Bible's true. It's happening. Mm-hmm. How could anybody not be a Christian now seeing all this be fulfilled? I know why. Most of the churches are controlled.
But, you know, there's this other problem called the pre-trib rapture. And I was a pre-tribber for the longest time. And the idea of these big mega churches are teaching their people the lie of the pre-trib. The idea that you don't have to worry about stuff like this because guess what? You're going to be checked right out of here in a twinkling of an eye. And I hate to tell everybody this, but if you really study your Bible, you're going to find that we are probably going to go through a lot of the tribulation. Just see, ask the Christians in Syria right now that are being beheaded.
200 plus thousand.
Tribulation's going on now.
And Obama won't let Christians out.
Yeah.
He laughs and goes, we got to let everybody out. No, he doesn't let them out. For every 300 Muslims, Sunnis, they'll let one Christian out as a sick joke.
Yeah. And you know the idea, you brought up another interesting topic. To bring in unvetted Syrians, and by the way, the FBI says we can't vet them.
They don't have proper
paperwork. And then the FBI said that up to 10% of them may be radicalized. Yeah, you know what? Would you let somebody that's a 1 in 10 chance that he's a rapist move into your living room? This isn't even suitable for discussion. You just don't do it. It's stupid. And that's one of the reasons Trump is resonating right now. He's saying the common sense things that these globalists, these idiots who are trying to create chaos, because they know that from chaos you can create order, order that gives them power to control it.
Gary and Mr. Norris, you have got to promise to come in at least every 2 months. I don't want to do this once a year. This is like once a year you come in. You live here in Austin part of the time. You know, you're up in North Texas. You guys have got to promise anytime you want, just talk to Nico, or let's just set up on your calendar where it's a done deal. Because this, I mean, I love this, is really good discussion.
Thank you. We enjoy it too, yeah. Alex. And it's really neat to get to listen to you on the radio and to be able to be here in person with you. I wish everybody could have this experience because if you think he's enthusiastic on the air, you ought to be sitting here with him.
Well, I'm not saying this just to say it. I mean, my gut, my spirit feels so good around you guys. And it's just amazing. I know we got more callers. I'm going to ask them if they want to stay with us when the guest comes on to ask a few questions. But I also want to go tape some stuff for the nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock. Part of it's live, part of it's taped. Sometimes it's all taped, sometimes it's all live. But sometimes we go for, you know, 6 hours live on the nightly news, 7 o'clock Central. It's when it kicks off with our great crew, Leanne McAdoo, Jakari Jackson, Darren McBreen, Rob Dew, David Knight, and all the rest of the amazing crew. By the way, David Knight's not in the film, but he's in the trailer. See it at AmerageddonTheMovie.com. I am your host, Alex Jones. Roger Stone's joining us in 2 minutes, getting him hooked up on Skype right now with huge breaking news. Before I go any further, we have the vitamin mineral fusion that took us 2 years to produce with the top developers in the country. What we believe is the best vitamin mineral amino acid trace element drink out there. Totally, completely organic and natural. Incredible high quality fruit punch, naturally flavored. It just tastes like fruit punch because the vitamins and minerals. We just call it that. It tastes delicious. It tastes like nothing you've ever tasted. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site. And you can get $10 off when you sign up for AutoShip. You can get free shipping on AutoShip. You can get free shipping on orders of $50 or more. There's a bunch of different specials that all compounded together automatically at checkout are just massive. And Vitamin Mineral Fusion is back, ladies and gentlemen. Check it out, a true game changer. We're also ending this on Sunday. I had to stop all of our high-quality storable food from My Patriot Supply, private labels, so we can discount it more as InfoWars Select. We had to stop doing it on the 60-plus packages they have, but their top four bestsellers are 40% off right now. Now is the time to get prepared. Anthroplex is back in stock. Incredible male and female. It says male, but it's for females too, I'm told by the chemists and researchers and doctors, to just boost your body's own natural potential. It is in. Both super male and female are sold out because we're trying to get the wet, you know, raw form of the herbs, and that's like going on a moon mission or something. It's not easy. That's why I said, can we just have a dry herb version? It's not as good, but it's dry herb, you know, a lot cheaper. Can I have that, please? Yes, we have it. So Anthroplex, it's excellent. It's organic, but it's just, you know, it's not cold pressed. Okay, I get it. That's why it's half the price. InfoWarsLife.com, 888-253-3139. And the globalists are doing everything they can right now to try to suppress this transmission. We told you months ago, Drudge talked about it, censorship on Facebook, blocking Drudge links. Now Congress has whistleblowers saying, no, we drop. We block InfoWars links. We block DrudgeReport.com links. It's happening because we're saying something they don't want to be heard, like having Roger Stone on or having his articles. Everything he's told us, everything has come true. Everything has happened. He told me 11 months ago they tried to steal the election at the primary level. And it all happened. They never did that before at this level, at this magnitude. And just on and on. He tells about the secret Koch brother meetings and the hundreds of millions they were raising. They said it wasn't true the next day. It came out a month later in the Washington Post. It was true. And I'm not kissing stones, but I'm just telling you, I've never talked to a political analyst. Usually they're shifty. They lie to you. They're like mentally ill sociopath weasels that like tell you some bull. No, even if it's bad news for Trump, he comes and says it. So that's why they call him dirty and deceptive and evil, because he's not. See, that's this inverted universe. Has he done some dirty tricks 20 years ago against communists? Well, I mean, that's like, yes, I mean, have I stepped on cockroaches in my kitchen at night? Have I caught them in the house? Yes, I've done it. But when it comes to telling the truth about what's really going on and being a patriot and exposing the Bushes and the JFK assassination and the pedophile rings and the Clintons and all of it, it's Roger Stone. There's Gizmodo, but it's now in the Washington Post. Former Facebook workers, we routinely suppress conservative news. When they say conservative, they mean the populist movement of Americana they call extreme right-wing garbage. Stone is opposed real right-wing crazies, so is I. He's just a populist, in my view. But enough about Stone, because he'll say, hey, it's about Trump. Big meetings with Ryan today. Spin coming out of that. Lewandowski, who he hasn't wanted to publicly criticize, saying that he runs the campaign. He's deciding who vice president is. I mean, am I electing Lewandowski, or am I electing Donald J. Trump? And listen, I'm not an infighter. Everybody knows it. But Lewandowski continually acts like an egomaniac out of control. And I'm concerned, my listeners are concerned organically about Lewandowski. So, Stone, you'll never talk about him on air. You don't want to talk about him behind the scenes. I talk to other folks inside the campaign who aren't scrabbling for power. These are people really above him doing the work. This Lewandowski does whatever he wants. What is going on with Lewandowski? What happened in the Ryan meeting? You talked about it last week. It's come out now that he was trying to broker all this power. You were confirmed again. So tell us what's currently happening and what's coming next. StoneZone.com. Roger, thanks for joining us.
Alex, first of all, let me compliment you on your spiffy-looking sports jacket there. You might make the best dressed list for 2016.
Thank you, sir.
Wish on New Year's Day, but don't bet on it. look, I'm delighted to be with you because, as you point out, the mainstream media is trying to suppress the news of the Trump revolution. And they're particularly trying to suppress any information regarding the Clintons, which may be negative, whether it is Bill's serial assaults of women and Hillary's threats against his sexual assault victims, or whether it is the corruption of the Clinton Foundation and the Clinton Global Initiative. So many times I think Americans can only go to Drudge, to Breitbart, InfoWars, to the Daily Caller, to Town Hall, and to another compendium of liberty-oriented sites. And thank God for that, but you're right. The New World Order folks are trying to even close down those outlets or censor those outlets.
Congress is now having hearings to shut us down. Drudge is a campaign operation by name, World Net Daily, All of Us Next. When they're the ones trying to censor us like we're Russia in 1960.
Yeah, no, look, my head is still spinning about the fact that CNN allows Ted Cruz to come on the air, attack me by name.
They say you're banned. They admit you're blacklisted. Talk about McCarthyism. So is MSNBC. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so they allow Cruz to attack me by name, but then they don't afford me the opportunity to respond, which, as you know, is journalistically unethical and I think proves the point that CNN, the Clinton News Network, as we call them in our office, they're not a news organization. They're an advocacy group for the Clintons. They are committed to hiding the Clintons' crimes and censoring anybody who would seek to criticize them. I mean, this was manifest just the other morning when Chris Cuomo asked Donald Trump, actually point blank said, "You are criticizing Hillary for her husband's indiscretions." Alex, this isn't about indiscretion. It's not about marital infidelity. It's not about adultery. It's not about girlfriends. It's about something far darker, sexual assault and rape. So when New York Magazine writes, Trump made these allegations about Hillary being an enabler without a scintilla of evidence. No, there's plenty of evidence. Living, breathing evidence. Juanita Broderick, Kathleen Willey, Paula Jones, Christy Zurcher, Sandra Allen James, and dozens of others.
Well, I mean, hasn't Bill settled cases where this was claimed? That's pretty pretty suspicious.
Yeah, he paid $850,000 to Paula Jones in the settlement of a civil case. Let's get to more important topics. The meetings today between Donald Trump and Paul Ryan, and then Donald Trump and Senator Mitch McConnell. I think that best I can see, the meeting of with the House leadership was inconclusive. They agreed to continue talking. But I think the problem here, of course, is that Paul Ryan is withholding his endorsement, not recognizing that his endorsement has little value in the bigger picture.
I was about to say, who wants his endorsement? It's like the endorsement of the Black Plague or gonorrhea?
Well, he's for open borders. He's for the international trade deals that have destroyed the American economy. The truth is, on issue after issue after issue, Speaker Ryan and Donald Trump have giant differences.
Sure. I mean, it's like having John Wayne Gacy endorse you. I think Trump should just say, I don't want your filthy endorsement.
Well, look, I think Trump is trying to be conciliatory because politics, he understands, is about addition, not subtraction. It's about inclusion, not exclusion.
If they're not sneaking around trying to slit your throat.
Well, but Donald Trump, at the end of the day, is not going to pay the Republican National, they're not going to authorize the Republican National Committee to pay an operation owned and controlled by Karl Rove to do $30 million worth of targeting and analytics work, which could have been done by an honest firm for $2 million.
So this is all about Karl Rove and the inside old neocons hijacking the entire Republican mammary gland, stealing all the milk for themselves and scuttling it for the witch Hillary.
Well, I think that's the larger implication. Yeah, this is about money. What they don't understand is that the Trump movement is bigger than the Republican Party. The Trump movement is not built around the need for party unity, because really the new measure here, Alex, is this is the Republicans and Democrats together against Donald Trump and everyone else.
That's it. It's the Republicans and Democrats against Trump and everybody else, the establishment against the populist, and Trump doesn't want to unify with Turd Blossom.
Well, if he has to have the endorsement of the Bushes and the Romneys, I think that that's a negative. I don't think that that is the requirement for winning the election. Here's my point. Expansion of the party is more important than party unity. I'm more interested in new voters than I am in old leaders. There are at least, based on my analysis, 1 million possible Trump voters, potential Trump voters, in the 10 states that are going to decide this election. The Trump campaign needs the machinery and the mechanism to go out and locate those folks and get them registered and then make sure they vote. That is a higher priority than the endorsement of Paul Ryan.
I totally agree. Let's talk about what happened at that meeting, and if I have a new family audience tuning in today. That's the name that the president, in his memoirs, and called Karl Rove, Turd Blossom, a horrible, miscreant creature, anti-conservative monster. So I'm asking people here, you know, who's more important, Turd Blossom or the actual voters? But what are you expecting them to strike back next with? You know, I warned you a few weeks ago, and I said, look, he's the presumptive nominee, clearly, but I expect them to double back and try to bring Cruz back later, or Paul Ryan, because, you know, TB is behind all this, so... What do you expect him to do? What do you make of those statements? And how do we defeat TB?
Well, first of all, let's be very clear. Rove did kind of a 360. Now he's for Trump, and he's going to work his magic to help Trump get elected. But he needs the element in the Republican Party, the donor element, to send him money. I mean, this is
He always does this. He always hijacks the Tea Party and milks it.
Yeah, this is as transparent as it can be. Look, Donald Trump doesn't trust Karl Rove. He doesn't like Karl Rove. He's been very direct about it. And if he has his way, I don't think the Republican National Committee will be lining the pockets of Karl Rove. The meeting with Ryan today, based on my intelligence, inconclusive. Nothing was really decided. Cordial. But Trump is not going to be extorted, and he's not going to be blackmailed. On the other hand, my report, from what I hear, the meeting with Senator Mitch McConnell went extremely well.
Oh, good.
He's on board. He understands that his members who may be concerned right now are the same guys who are going to be desperate to get on the platform with Trump and get in the picture in late October. The Trump revolution is coming. This wave is coming.
Exactly.
As a good enough politician to see it. So he's being cooperative. He's being constructive. And he has a long history with
Trump. Well, let me stop you because, listen, I've got a few other insiders not as high up as you are. I know you're outside the campaign, but former head of it and a confidant of Trump. I don't have anything out for Lewandowski. I don't dislike him. I'm just an outsider patriot. But that's kind of good because I'm not in this whole echo chamber. I hear Lewandowski's deciding who the people are. I make calls. They go, no, that's not true. Trump's upset. Is that true? And if so, what is Lewandowski doing running around acting like he is the Karl Rove, you know, Bush's brain to Trump? Because I know that's not true. So what's going on with Lewandowski? Is this the Lewandowski campaign or the Trump campaign? Come on, answer my question. You'll never do it. Do it, Stone. I'm getting a little mad here. Just okay?
Let me be as clear as I can without betraying confidences. Donald Trump is not controlled by anyone. He is his own man.
Lewandowski. Look, I'm sorry. Just Lewandowski. I don't like what he's doing.
I'll come back to it. Just let me build my case. Nobody puts words in Donald Trump's mouth, including Corey Lewandowski. Nobody is going to choose the candidate for vice president other than Donald J. Trump. And knowing him, he's going to keep his list very close to the vest until he's ready to disclose it. He's the master of good public relations. So the Washington Post story that said that Corey Lewandowski will oversee the effort to choose the vice presidential nominee is false. The Washington Post's sources on that are incorrect. This was news to Donald Trump, according to an AP reporter, who downplayed it in an interview when he was asked whether Corey Lewandowski was indeed spearheading this effort. Trump said, and I quote, well, we're kind of all leading it, everyone on the committee, which is a deflection, in my opinion. Now, Donald Trump is smart enough to know that open discord in his campaign is not helpful. But it is very clear that some in the entourage are more interested in feathering their own nest. Some in the entourage are more interested in measuring the drapes in their White House office, while others who are consummate political professionals like Paul Manafort are keeping their head down, not playing the press game to try to burnish their own standing and their own image, but focusing on getting Donald J. Trump elected president.
Exactly. I'm no rocket scientist, but half the time it's like Lewandowski is who we're talking about. And you never make it about Stone or other. In fact, you tell me not to do that, and I get it. But, I mean, they just make it about Lewandowski. This guy is like a prancing junior high quarterback that thinks he's, you know, Errol Flynn, and he's never even bagged a check yet.
Well, and very sadly, he has no record of ever electing anyone.
Own man, Lewandowski, a lightweight, is running things when you have helped with your business partner, Manford, and others get the heaviest hitters there are in there that are patriots. And then we've got this guy running around like a baby goose, honking that he's the king. I mean, I'm just sick. It's not an ego thing for me. I want Trump to win. And you've got like a corporal trying to run the field marshal command base, in my view.
Well, and let me point out that Corey is still on the campaign payroll. Every day I work with dozens of people who have left their businesses, left their families to help Donald Trump, who are being compensated nothing, not even their expenses.
And they're banning you in the media because you're so effective.
And they're Ron Paul supporters, they're Ronald Reagan supporters, they're people I've known back to the Young Republicans, they're former Republican state chairmen, former members of Congress like Billy Hendon, who's a great patriot. These people are giving up their time and their money, and they're leaving their families to come work for free. Those are the heroes of this campaign.
And then lightweight Lewandowski is causing scandal after scandal, always making it about him in the headlines.
I think it's unfortunate, and it just doesn't serve the candidate well. Let's leave it there.
All right, I'm going to stop. I know you may have to go in 3-4 minutes. If you can do five more in the next hour, I've got a few other questions. Gary Haven is one of the top Republican donors out there. He's got a big hit film, Armageddon, about to enter theaters. He was already here. I just asked him to stay because I thought he might have some good questions for you. We're going to come back in a minute, have him ask Roger Stone a few questions, StoneZone.com. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. I'm going to do a 30-second plug because of time, and I'm even skipping breaks here. Great nutraceuticals, great storable foods, great Hillary for President shirts, Molon Labe, you name it, InfoWarsStore.com. 40% off on our top-selling storable foods. That's only running till the weekend. We ended the general sale, but on the four top sellers, it's still going. Take advantage of that. Vitamin Mineral Fusion back in stock. InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals. InfoWarsStore.com is the big umbrella site. Or call toll-free 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We can answer your questions or comments. We're humbled and thankful for your support. We try to bring you the very best water filtration systems, non-GMO seeds, you name it, shortwave radios. you name it, that we use, that we've vetted, that we've tested at the lowest prices. Some of our prices are below Amazon. A lot of our products are exclusive to us. Thank you for giving us a look. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or 888-253-3139. Gary Haven, I want to introduce you to Roger Stone. And it was Haven here over a year ago that said he'd met with Cruz at the governor's mansion and was creeped out by him. And so he helped, you know, in the last few months torpedo Cruz. A lot of big interviews. I don't know if Stone knows who you are, but I certainly admire the work you've done. I want to get you two big brains together. Mr. Haven, go ahead and say hi and a few questions for Mr. Stone or comments.
Hey, Roger, it's really great to meet you. What a privilege. I'm shaking your hand across the airways as we speak right now.
I'm very well familiar with your work. You've done the Lord's work. You're out there. You're a patriot, and you have my respect, sir.
Oh, thank you. That's really good to know. A couple of questions I have for you. One, I just admire your courage. Man, you're standing up to a machine that has a trail of bodies as far as
I was about to ask, does he get threats? We worry about Trump.
Yeah. Do you have good protection? Are you, you know, you're poking a grizzly bear?
Well, my security people asked me not to talk about it, but I have increased my personal security and that around my home. My wife, of course, is very concerned about this because the Clintons have a track record of having people savagely beaten, like Gary Johnson, who is a witness to Bill's involvement with Jennifer Flowers, or Jerry Parks, who I believe Bill Clinton had murdered because of what he knew about Bill's past. So it's a legitimate concern. Let me say this, as I do in every time this question comes up. Alex, if in a couple weeks they tell you that I committed suicide because I was depressed, or if I get hit by a truck crossing the street,
or struck by a bolt of lightning,
I tell you I was killed in a freak hunting accident, don't believe it. Hillary Clinton's the major perp, and she needs to be exposed. I'm in perfectly good health. I'm in a great mood. I am working 18-hour days. I want to be honest with you. I wouldn't make it without Brain Force. I went online. I bought some Brain Force. I pop those in the morning. I pop those at night, and I get 4 or 5 more hours of work. So
I didn't know that was coming. I know you got more interviews coming up, but Roger Stone, 70-second break. Here with Gary Haven, Marigold, the new movie. Come back, 70 seconds. Finish up the lavish plug for Brainforce, but a few other questions for Mr. Haven. Then we have our guest host, Anthony Gucciardi, taking over. Roger Stone's our guest, StoneZone.com. The tip of the spear in the populist movement behind Trump to restore the republic. Back in 70. The best part of my job is knowing people like Roger Stone and Gary Haven and Matt Drudge and all these other folks that are great patriots but scared to go on air, and Mike Norris and Chuck Norris. I always loved Kurt Russell. Turns out he's a listener and a patriot. I always loved, I'm not bragging, it's just how many people are fellow travelers in a liberty way, not a communist way. Even Jeff Bridges, big listener. It's like any actor I love, they end up being a listener. Of course, they're patriots. They're cool. We resonate. We pick up on that. And Trump's only a manifestation of that. And I think he knows that. I know you've got a few final questions. I've got some. Roger Stone, at his core, seeing this, Trump realizes this is history, this is destiny. It's not some egomaniac thing. He really does care about America. He knows the globalists hate America. He's trying to make a stand against him. He knows he's on a potential mission that'll destroy him politically or even physically. Quite frankly, a suicide mission, some could call it. Who is, in 60 seconds, Donald Trump, and any other tidbits?
Above all, he's his own man. He's a nationalist. He's a patriot. He totally gets it. He's not a fan of Wall Street. He's not a fan of K Street. But above all, he is fiercely independent. And Alex, I got to tell you, I've dealt with some very tough customers, Richard Nixon among them. Donald Trump is the toughest human being I've ever met with. He is mentally tough in a negotiation, which I've seen firsthand. This man has ice water in his veins. So when it comes to dealing with the Russians or the Chinese or any of our adversaries, he's the man you want. He's not a social worker. He's not a weakling. He's not Barack Obama. He is the tough guy we need, both mentally tough and physically tough.
And he's not a fake guy, I've been told. I mean, he just genetically wants a good deal for everybody and just won't be pushed around. And that's why they're scared of him. They're scared to death of him.
Yeah, and I think above all, his greatest single commitment really is to economic growth. He remembers what the American dream was like when he was growing up, and now he sees all these kids getting out of college, spend their parents going deep into debt or them going to debt themselves.
He'd rather just be a great patriot and a great American, not a buzzard feeding on our skeleton. Gary Haven, quick question for the consummate Trump insider, Roger Stone.
You know, Roger, I was invited for the third time by Eric Beach to be on a small group of advisors for Trump. And I've been waiting for my movie to come out, so I wouldn't have a biased opinion on it. But today and yesterday, Pat Buchanan wrote an article saying that Trump should not taint his victory by going to these establishment Republicans and trying to get them to cooperate. And I think you talked a good bit about that today. You know, Trump's movement is because people are waking up and they've realized their country's been stolen. And he is providing the leadership that gives us hope that we can take it back. So do you think that that there's enough of us freedom-minded people to drive Trump to victory without compromising with the establishment?
Yeah, I think that's precisely the point. In other words, if this were Republicans versus Democrats, then the concept of party unity would be crucial. You would need every possible Republican. The point is that Donald Trump is bigger than the Republican Party, and he has the capability to bring millions of Democrats and independents.
What's he already brought? 2.5 million more in?
Yeah.
So we already have 3 million more voters than they do. Let's take Florida, for example. Mitt Romney lost in the general election in Florida by 30,000 votes. 350,000 more people voted for Trump in the Republican primary in Florida than voted for Mitt Romney 4 years ago. The handwriting's on the wall. Trump can carry Florida. Now, I have concerns about the group that Mr. Beach is associated with because they have a $600,000 debt. And of the $1 million they claim to spend in Wisconsin, a more careful reading shows that they only spent $100,000.
Well, so we're going to do this. I'm going to get you, if it's okay, I'm going to give Mr. Haven your number right when this broadcast ends, Mr. Stone.
Sure, I'd be happy to talk
to you. You guys can talk right after the show. We'll right after I end here. We've got Anthony Gucciardi about to come in and take over with all the fresh news and info. Roger Stone, thanks for all the inside baseball. We'll talk to you soon. Have a great weekend coming up, sir.
Great to be with you, as always. And Gary, my regards.
Thank you. Glad to meet you.
All right, Gary Haven, congratulations on Amerageddon coming out tonight and tomorrow and already having hit reviews. Thank you so much. And to you and Mr. Norris and others, God bless you.
Hillary Clinton's days are numbered, or so it would appear. During the past few weeks, the FBI has dragged in Hillary's assistant, Huma Abedin, and Brian Pagliano, the IT specialist believed to have set up and maintained Clinton's server. Pagliano was given full immunity in exchange for his help with the investigation. An investigation narrowing down the correct answers to questions surrounding the emails on Hillary's private server deemed confidential that placed national security at a high level of risk while Hillary made a mockery of the U.S. Secretary of State office.
By the way, you may have seen that I recently launched a Snapchat account. I love it. I love it. Those messages disappear all by themselves.
As the investigation appears to wind down, Hillary will be interviewed by the FBI in a matter of days or weeks regarding the answers the FBI now has to questions that must be corroborated by Hillary. The FBI and the Justice Department have denied any knowledge of whether or not the investigation is closing or whether or not Hillary is the target of the investigation. But The Hill reports Stephen Levin, a former federal prosecutor and current partner at the law firm Levin & Kurlitz, said, "This certainly sends the signal that they are nearing an end to their investigation. Typically, the way we structured the investigations when I was a federal prosecutor is that we would seek to interview the target last." Stephen Levin continues, "As you begin to interview people who are extremely close to the target of an investigation, people who are considered confidants, you typically interview those people towards the final stages of the investigation. So that way, if they tell you something that is contrary to something you've already learned, you can immediately challenge them on that information." Tech activist Marcel Lazar, a.k.a. Guccifer, claims to have breached Hillary's server at least twice. Guccifer said he first compromised Clinton confidant Sidney Blumenthal's AOL account in March of 2013 and used that as a stepping stone to the Clinton server. He said he accessed Clinton's server, like, twice, though he described the contents as not interesting to him at the time. Doodles by Bill Clinton appear to back up Guccifer's claims that were released as far back as 2013. It bears repeating the extent to which Hillary violated her position in the State Department, because most people have become completely accustomed to corruption as business as usual. Here are the facts. As the nation's chief diplomat, Hillary Clinton was responsible for ascertaining whether information in her possession was classified and acknowledged that negligent handling of that information could jeopardize national security, according to a copy of an agreement she signed upon taking the job. A day after assuming office as Secretary of State, Clinton signed a sensitive compartmented information non-disclosure agreement that laid out criminal penalties for any unauthorized disclosure of classified information. The sensitive compartmented information non-disclosure agreement details how Hillary has been granted access to sensitive compartmented information, or SCI, classified information. The agreement states that Hillary hereby acknowledges that the disclosure of SCI may constitute violations of United States criminal laws, and that nothing in the agreement constitutes a waiver by the United States of the right to prosecute for any statutory violation. The agreement is also severable, meaning if one part is unenforceable, the remainder of the provisions in the agreement remain in full force and effect. Bottom line, U.S. intelligence officials determined at least four and up to 305 of the emails Hillary's aides printed out were from Hillary's personal server and were SCI at the time they were written. Two of the emails discussed classified drone information deemed top secret by the CIA. Hillary Clinton faces 10 years behind bars as required under the Espionage Act. Jeffrey Sterling, a CIA leak, was sentenced to 3.5 years after disclosing national defense information concerning a covert operation. And General David Petraeus was slapped with 2 years probation and a fine of $100,000 for revealing classified documents to his mistress. Petraeus, a former director of the CIA, a four-star general, and CENTCOM commander, had served our country for 37 years. So why would Hillary Clinton deserve immunity? Ignorance and/or negligence of Hillary's possession of highly sensitive, classified emails is no joke. In fact, if Hillary does walk away from this investigation with a slap on the wrist, after she personally went to great lengths to cover up a mountain of evidence, the entire farce will demonstrate just how far gone the Federal Bureau of Investigation and the Justice Department really are. Hillary's path of deception could even serve to take those departments to the cleaners if Donald Trump becomes president and keeps his word. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
The reason I'm here today is to encourage the U.S. Congress to take action to protect our country from its most imminent threat. Electricity would cease, the internet would go down, and the banking system.
The smokescreen of national security used by government at every level.
A strong America is the only thing standing in the way. Country only needs a little chaos.
We have a fog that has descended on our entire nation.
Hello, Mr. President. Now is the time.
The average American family only has 3 days of food.
We need to talk face to face. This is important.
Sir, what's the mission? Disarm the population and restore order.
Do you have any weapons inside your home or on your person?
You had to give the president power to arrest any American by simply accusing them of terrorism.
The vanity of nationalism will quickly fade. These are but the birth pangs of a new world order.
I'm just so afraid of the world that you're going to have to grow up in.
This is a time, man, woman, young or old, when folks run and hide. Or they pull up their bootstraps and they fight.
When you sell your soul, it's a one-time thing. There's no going back.
Well, there it is. It's Amerageddon. And grassroots films, independent films are an amazing thing. Independent anything is generally an amazing thing when it comes to comparing it to, I mean, I don't know if you've seen the AAA movies out recently. They are just, many of them are just so terrible. And apparently it's because when you translate these movies into other countries, because obviously they make more money internationally, like China and stuff, it's hard to translate a complex script. So you can't translate something that was like Shawshank Redemption. That's not going to translate well to a bunch of different languages, and it's too hard, and the overdubbing and stuff. So they make it so simple and so stupid that any AAA movie now can be translated easily
into other languages and be shown in other countries, and they still make sense. So it can't be anything too much. So that's Armageddon. And if you've seen the show today, Chuck Norris's son directing it, and Gary Haven, a bunch of amazing people. So go out. It comes tonight in a preview, but it's officially launching tomorrow. Armageddon.com. Check it out. Anyway, I'm Anthony Gucciardi, and this is the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. I'm always excited to be invited on as a guest host. And I'll tell you what, there's a lot of stuff to talk about today. The big stories that we're going to cover are Bayer said to explore bid for $40 billion seed company Monsanto. So mega pharmaceutical German company Bayer may actually buy Monsanto. Then we're going to have Kit Daniels come in the next segment and talk about Harvard scientists say Rio 2016 Olympics could spark, quote, full-blown global health disaster. That's from The Independent. And that Zika concerns prompt call to, quote, postpone or move Rio Olympic Games. Interesting stuff about that, because if I recall, Zika, everyone, the government said it was no big deal, and then they said it was a big deal, and then doctors said it was causing all these problems and leading to birth defects, and then a bunch of doctors said it wasn't, and it's kind of a no man's land on the truth about that, but now it seems like it's being hyped up again, so we'll see. Is it actually a bigger deal than they say, or is this just complete hype? We'll talk to Kit and look into that. Also, today, 0 to 400 miles per hour in mere seconds. Welcome to the age of Hyperloop. This is a very cool concept, like a super, super fast train. It goes 700 miles an hour, and they've actually got video of them testing it out and it working, the very, very alpha stages of it. But we're also going to talk about that and how the illusion of safety makes us think that's scary. Like going on a train that could go up to 700 miles an hour if done right. They have, you know, 400 here. That is scary if you watch the video, right? That train could kill people. Meanwhile, America's number three killer is medical errors, and you get into a car, you could basically die at any point. And we're going to talk about normalcy and how the worst thing in the world is trying to be normal and trying to have this illusion of safety at all times. Because at the end of the day, all it is an illusion. And all that happens when you try to be normal and not talk about things that matter and not talk about this news because it might ruffle some feathers and people might think you're weird is just devastating consequence, and it affects the entire society. So we're going to talk about that. U.S. poultry workers denied breaks and forced to wear diapers on the job. That's real safe, too. They are in danger of serious health problems, report says. Tyson says it doesn't tolerate refusal of restroom requests. So this poultry company said, no, you're not allowed to go to the bathroom. Just wear diapers. So they're handling our chickens that we're eating, putting on the dinner table, wearing diapers. You cannot make this stuff up. Meanwhile, massive frozen produce recall underway as 7 are hospitalized. Kind of an indicator that maybe some strange things are going on. Obviously, those two are not connected. But if you look at the state of a lot of these manufacturing facilities, trust me, I've seen them, it's not very good, okay? And for all the bureaucracy out there to keep us all safe and the white glove handling and the mega inspections, it's amazing what people get away with, washing things with underwear and stuff. Anyway, be right back. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. This is the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. All right, it's that time again. It's time for politicians and scientists to warn of a global pandemic. Now, I'll tell you what. I'm not saying this isn't the case. It could be. I've got Kit Daniels in here because I want to talk to him about this. I remember so many different times not knowing if the politicians and the political scientist people were just pushing a disease outbreak down and acting like it's no big deal to give the illusion of safety and give the illusion of comfort. I do remember in Fukushima when the Japanese government said everything's fine, everything's great. And of course, independent studies would confirm it's 1.5 to 3 times worse than they said it was. And 70% of the cesium went into the Pacific Ocean. It was really bad. It was a really, really bad thing. But I also remember the swine flu and, you know, how that was supposed to be the biggest thing ever, and the government said it was basically going to kill people and it'd be horrible and watch out and you better get your shots and all this stuff. And here we are again with the Zika virus. And what I want to ask Kit Daniels, because he wrote up a story on InfoWars about this, about what people are saying. It's not him saying it. Here's the crazy part from The Independent. Harvard scientists say Rio 2016 Olympics could spark, quote, full-blown global health disaster. And then another one here. Zika concerns prompt call to postpone or move Rio Olympic Games. So give us a brief overview of what's going on and why scientists are saying this could be a major global health disaster, and if it's just overblown or if it's true in your view.
Well, right now you got Brazil. It's completely overwhelmed by this pandemic, Zika. You got the military that's completely mobilized. They can't stop the mosquitoes. They're doing everything they can stop the mosquitoes. So now you got this whole city, Rio de Janeiro, I believe is how you pronounce it. You know, you got people that are dying left and right. They're completely infected, and yet you got these Olympics that are coming into town. And one thing I want to point out is that governments, they always expand by using a crisis like this. So, you know, as long as people see government as the solution, politicians can always sell whatever solution they want to the public to get what they want to expand the size and scope of the government. And so when it comes to Zika, let's say, for example, Zika's, you know, completely overblown. It's not that big a deal. It's not as big of a deal as, say, Ebola.
Right.
You can still have the government over-exaggerate the threat of Zika to, you know, get more bigger budgets, like the CDC, for example. They love this kind of stuff because it gives them an excuse to go to Congress and say, we got to have bigger budgets. We got to have, you know, more equipment, whatnot, more power.
It's a great motivator.
Yeah.
Pull on fear is a great motivator. You know, it was declared a World Health Emergency by the World Health Organization. The number of suspected cases in Rio is the highest of any state in the country. And I've been looking into this, and quite frankly, there's no, you know, It's anyone's guess if it's actually this bad, honestly, is the conclusion I've come to. But to postpone or move the Rio Olympic Games and say there could be a full-blown global health crisis, basically what you're saying is it doesn't even matter if that's true. The key is that overblowing it for beneficial gain in a very corrupt way that doesn't care about public health is the primary concern.
That's interesting.
Talk a little bit more about that.
That's the flip side. It's like, let's say that this isn't, they're not trying to exploit the crisis, or they're not trying to kill people by letting people get infected by Zika. You still got the angle in which you have government and politicians that are putting public health at risk in order to make money at the Olympics. So that's a completely different angle, but still a very credible angle. And another thing that really scares me about this, Anthony, is like, unlike the Ebola crisis, the alternative media, we're not reporting on something that the mainstream media is not picking up first. Instead, what we're doing right now is we're reporting on what these Harvard Review scientists are reporting that the mainstream media already picked up on. I just went with a slightly different angle about it. And I saw this one thing in the Harvard Review that I even missed this morning when I wrote my article. It says, while Brazil Zika inevitably will spread globally, given enough time, viruses always do, it helps nobody to speed that up. So, and then you had the World Health Organization, when the Zika virus was spreading, like I think in October, they went to Switzerland and said, this is a big deal. We got to find a cure for this. But now they won't even release a statement about Zika's impact on Olympic Games. That's really scary. And it's also really scary when you got Harvard scientists, which is like the top of the establishment, you know, breaking away and saying, hey, what's going on here? Yeah, exactly.
You know, and it is a key point, and it does remind me what I'm going to talk about in the next segment. We're also going to play your video that kind of relates to this. You know, you've got 400-mile-per-hour trains, the Zika virus, people are freaking out about the safety. Meanwhile, you have a higher percentage chance of dying in your car or, you know, medical errors and all this kind of stuff. It is a tool of just complete control to freak people out about this kind of stuff from the government angle and then seize more control and power. We'll be back in the next segment. I did want you to tell me about your video, but I think we'll have to premiere it coming up in the next segment. Awesome. This is the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Guicciardi, Kit Daniels. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. This is the fourth hour. We'll be right back this morning. Right. This is the Alex Jones Show, but I'm Anthony Guicciardi, and this is the fourth hour. And I'll tell you what, there's a lot of news, probably more news than I've had ever before while being invited to host the show. But first and foremost, I wanted to read an article I just saw on CNN during the break that's really, really interesting. Study, acetaminophen dulls your pain, but also your empathy. This is on the front page of CNN. The side effect of popping a pain reliever containing acetaminophen are well known. You may get stomach pains. You may feel nauseated. We'll add another possible one to the list. You'll feel less inclined to empathize with your fellow man. A new study by researchers at Ohio State University found that acetaminophen, the main ingredient in Tylenol, and about 600 other medicines dulls you to the trials and tribulations of others. By the way, these are the same researchers that found the medication can suck the joy out of life for you. And if you click that, it talks about how it reduces your ability to experience pleasure. Feeling so happy you can't stand it, you might want to pop some acetaminophen. New study found that acetaminophen, the main ingredient in Tylenol, most forms of Midol and other 600 medications, but also reduces pain and pleasure. Crazy stuff. And I don't take acetaminophen almost ever because of all the research out there also about the toxic effects at low doses and things like that. I do take pain relievers sometimes because I have extremely bad neck pain from Lyme disease, but acetaminophen I try to avoid, definitely. And it's very interesting to find that it dulls your pleasure and ability to feel empathy for others. You know how many people are on acetaminophen-based pain relievers every single day? Maybe that's why they are not exactly empathetic to what's going on in the world. One of many reasons. And all the other things that people are on. And all the television that people are watching and their inability to talk about real topics. That's what I wanted to talk about on this segment specifically. Kind of hinted at it a bunch of different times with the Hyperloop stuff and everything like that. But let me just give you a few headlines. America's number three killer is medical errors, says study. Imagine wiping out the entire population of Orlando, Florida each year. That's essentially what medical errors are doing, according to an analysis of four studies on the topic that was published in the BMJ on Tuesday. 9.5% of Americans who die each year are killed by a medical error, making it the number three cause of death behind heart disease and cancer. Now, am I reading this to attack the medical industry? No, I'm actually not. I'm highlighting a point here, highlighting a point about how things really work. Massive frozen produce recall underway, seven hospitalized. Over 350 possibly tainted frozen vegetable products sold at over 40 different brands, years worth of production are being recalled due to listeria contamination. Seven people are in the hospital. Another example, if 10% of smokers quit, $63 billion would be saved in the U.S. alone, and obviously tons of lives. So if 1 in 10 people in the U.S. chose to stop smoking, $63 billion in healthcare costs would be saved in the next year. So all this builds up to the juxtaposition of something like this Hyperloop. 0 to 400 miles per hour in mere seconds. We talked about it. The Hyperloop, the ultra-fast train they just tested, and there's a video of it succeeding. Now, when I talk about produce, though, it doesn't scare you. When I talk about driving in a car, it doesn't scare you. And to most people, when you go to the doctor and they prescribe you something, again, not just attacking the medical industry, when you go to the doctor and they prescribe you something, well, this is for your allergies, this is for your pain, this is for your headaches, this is for your back issues. That's not scary to most people. That's actually comforting. It gives them what I call the illusion of safety. But getting in the car does not. It also does not affect them. So they get in the car, they go to the doctor, they get to prescribe things. But in reality, the number three killer is medical errors, surgical errors, pharmaceutical deaths, etc. The number three killer besides cancer and heart disease. No one thinks about that. No one thinks about that. No one thinks, man, this train looks scary or this plane is scary. You ever fly on an airplane? Man, I used to be deathly afraid of airplanes. The lack of control you have, right? You're just sitting in this tin metal death trap and you're like going through the air and then you hit some turbulence, right? You're like freaking out. One time I was on an airplane and the emergency lights came on and the mask came down and I was just like, I'm going to die, right? I'm not too afraid of flying anymore, but I used to be. I'm like, oh man, I'm going to die. Or being in a boat or something. What this is, it's a disassociation with reality. It's a disassociation with reality where our brain says something is big and scary and spooky, but it's not. And that's what we're talking about with the Zika. Maybe it is a big deal. I'm sure people are suffering in Rio de Janeiro, and it's actually very sad. But when we think about these spooky, spooky things, it makes us act irrationally. For example, I didn't want to fly on airplanes. There's a 1 in 20 million chance that you actually get into a plane crash on an airplane, let alone die. 1 in 20 million. There's a better chance, most likely, that one of these lights is going to blow up and kill me. There's a better chance that I will have an aneurysm. There's a better chance all of these things could happen. But instead, We aren't motivated by facts, logic, information, and statistics. Have we ever been? Absolutely not. No way. We're motivated by what our brain perceives to be reality. And the sooner we can understand this, the better and more efficiently and quicker we can actually do something about turning things around. And that's what the news cycle understands. That's what the news corporations understand. When they put something out, they don't sit there and back it up with 6 or 7 paragraphs of information and statistics. They don't do that. And you know what's sad? I don't do that either sometimes. You know why? Because people, at the end of the day, don't even care. I've done the studies on reading charts about how far people go down. You know, this audience obviously is way more educated and intelligent than the ones I'm talking to right now. But But if most people go into an article, they read about, like, here's the headline, here's the first paragraph. They'll go down, like, the first paragraph, and they'll exit the page, like 70%. Okay, they don't even want to read. And articles are on the way out now. Now it's just images, posters, and videos. That is how we've come to this part where there's so much crazy things going on because we don't respond based on real logic. We don't respond based on that. And that's how people are able to get away with things. Like this article, world's 10 most corrupt countries have received 2.7 billion euros in UK aid since David Cameron became prime minister. The world's 10 most corrupt countries have received 2.7 billion in British aid during David Cameron's time as prime minister, according to official figures. And it kind of cuts off because a lot of articles, even though they're mainstream, can't print properly. But basically, these politicians, man, they are so corrupt. It's such a joke. It is such a joke. Like when you go to the TSA, as I recently did, and they say, excuse me, you've been selected for a palm swabbing. Please stand over here for 5 minutes and let me inconvenience you to swab off your palms. Yeah, you're keeping America safe. You're really keeping America safe. It's all a big joke. But this is a big joke, too, because how many people do you think are really going to read all about how David Cameron, the UK under David Cameron, gave all this aid to foreign countries and everything like that and actually do something about it? Huh? It's a sad state, but you know what it is? And this isn't all just we're all doom and gloom, okay? It's leading up to something. Why don't people want to talk about all this stuff? Why, if you share this video on YouTube or you share this stream right now, you say, hey, you should watch this program. It's really interesting. This crazy guy is talking about stuff that's actually important and matters and can actually do something. They'll watch it and they'll say, this is crazy. This is stupid. This is a conspiracy, whatever. You're insane. You're whatever. I'm going to label you all day long so I can disregard you. Why do they do that? Because they want to fit in and be the normal word. They want to be normal. They want to achieve normalcy. They want social status with their friends and family. And you will not be normal and accepted if you go against the status quo in any way whatsoever. And that's how it's built. So if you, I mean, imagine if you went to like some dinner party, and again, a lot of the listeners right now are totally aware and in all of this, but the average person go to like a dinner party with friends and family, and you're like, hey, did you know that David Cameron is like funding all these corrupt countries and all the other things we're talking about? Did you know about all that? Did you know about the corruption, the deep-seated corruption? Did you know about the government waste spending? Did you know about the actual stuff that's going on at the border? Did you know about the taxicab industry lobbying different governments for deregulation and banning all this, millions in illegal citations from the New York police? Did you know that this major study said that cancer is man-made that we're going to talk about, that cancer is a modern disease caused by environmental factors and pollution from the University of Manchester? Do you know about the Bayer acquisition of Monsanto for $40 billion that might go down? Do you know about how China tried to smuggle a spy posing as an interpreter into a carriage with the queen? They'd be like, what? Can we just talk about football already? What's the weather like? They'd be like, are you insane? Get out of here, you weirdo. You know why? Because you're not being normal. And being normal and being a rule follower is the worst thing you can do for your life. It's the worst thing you can do for the future of humanity and the whole entire planet. And I want to read something about being normal and being a rule follower and the normalcy, status quo lifestyle that we've been conditioned to fit into. It's powerful writing. See if I can do it some justice. This is by Bryant McGill, and it says, Rule followers are merciless rule enforcers. They are the vicious administrators of the status quo. Rule followers commonly derive their sense of superiority from following and enforcing convention and from being right. You know anyone like that? They delight in prosecuting you with their piety and judgments. It is often the most responsible, sensible, reliable, and dependable people who will viciously destroy you and your dreams and the greatness within you. Okay, we're talking about people that want to be normal and will attack you for saying anything about what's going on in the world or actually caring. Normal is a failure of imagination, it goes on to say. Normal is an easygoing oppression. Normal is a silent violence against progress. Normal is an insidious benevolence, a sweet tool of conformity responsible for incalculable loss. Normal is the greatest constraint and coercive force in the world. If you do not feel the constant threat and ruthless pressure of normalcy bearing down on you, it is because you are part of it, an unknowing devotee of the unremarkable. It's by Bryant McGill. I'll tell you what, that summarizes it right there, doesn't it? Being normal, you are an unknowing devotee of the unremarkable if you are someone that refuses to do anything outside of the status quo because you want deep acceptance by people that are weak, that you want to be a part of the establishment system that says you're nothing. You want to join what I call the establishment meat grinder, which means don't do anything of note. Don't you dare do anything of note. How dare I even come on here and talk about this? How dare I? Let me tell you what. People get mad when you cover news. People get mad when you pick stuff from the mainstream media and the regular media system and you talk about it because it can challenge them. Because they can't dismiss you as some wacky kook. And I'm not even saying anything that crazy. But the establishment meat grinder will put you through its system and you will come out the other end, if you let it, a devotee of the unremarkable. Normal is what kills. Normalcy is the killer of all greatness. It is a terrible thing. You are better than that. Anyway, some thoughts on that. So please do not be normal. Now let's hit some more news. We may go ahead and play a special report as well coming up about how people are just so disassociated with reality. They're so stuck in the system of smart tech and everything like that, which is a beautiful thing, and technology is a beautiful thing, but they're not even having real physical contact or real human interaction anymore. So that's a video from Kit that I was talking about earlier. Might play that here shortly. But first, let's talk about some things that are challenging the normalcy. This is an interesting story. How China tried to smuggle a spy posing as an interpreter into carriage carrying the queen during last year's state visit. Police commander confirmed incident in New Garden party footage. A Chinese spy tried to get into the Queen's carriage with her during last year's state visit. Lucy Dorsey, who was in charge of security for President Xi Jinping's visit in October, was filmed by the monarch's official cameraman saying, "Well, they also wanted to come in your carriage with the interpreter." The Queen appeared to be well briefed about the incident as she nodded and replied with a firm yes. So, a little bit of weirdness in there. Here's a topic you're not allowed to talk about. Abortion rates reach historic low in developed countries. Even say that word and you're bad. Abortion rates in developed countries are at a historic low, according to a new report, mostly due to increased use of contraception. However, the rates of abortion have remained unchanged in developing countries where the practice is often unsafe. Man who claims to have invented email sues Gawker for $35 million in libel suit. So, I think you might have seen Hulk Hogan win, and he goes, "Well, gee, I'm going to sue too." The same lawyers who successfully sued Gawker Media over Hulk Hogan's sex tape has now sued the online publisher again, this time representing a Massachusetts man who claims he invented email in 1978 at the age of 14. Who knows? Who knows? On Tuesday, Charles Harder bought a libel suit on behalf of Shiva Ayodhari, a man who has gone on years-long campaign trying to convince the world that he and he alone invented email. I don't know why that's Gawker's problem, but I guess it is. And then this story here, very interesting one that we may have missed. It's from 2010. Someone sent it to me today. And it says, study is a man-made disease. Study strongly suggests cancer is a man-made disease. Cancer is a modern man-made disease caused by environmental factors such as pollution and diet. A study reviewed by the University of Manchester scientists has strongly suggested. Their study of remains in literature from ancient Egypt and Greece and earlier periods carried out Manchester's K&H Center for Biomedical Egyptology and published in the Nature Reviews, cancer includes the first historical diagnosis of cancer in Egyptian mummy, finding only one case of the disease in the investigation of hundreds of Egyptian mummies with few references to cancer in literary evidence, proves that cancer was extremely rare in antiquity. The disease rate has risen massively since the Industrial Revolution, in particular childhood cancer, proving that the rise is not simply due to people living longer. And I would argue also that there's genetic factors for everything, 100%. There's no question. There's numerous diseases that can be shown to relate to your genetic predisposition and your genetic makeup. But I would also say that it's been said time and time again, genetics are like the bullets in the gun. You have to pull the trigger, right? So even if you have a genetic predisposition to something, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get it 100%. It also has to do with lifestyle. I mean, you can't debate with me that if you go out every night partying and eat fast food and drink no water, you're going to get sick. Okay? That's not because of a magical thing that happened. That's not your genes. You're not genetically predisposed to get sick from partying. Okay? Some people can party longer. Some people can eat worse. But it doesn't mean that, oh, it's just my genes. It's a breakdown of the body. It's a complete breakdown of the body. And what happens is you're having something internally wrong, and the body is showing signs and symptoms. It's expressing itself saying, hey, there's lots of stuff going wrong in here. And if you ignore that for too long, you're going to have a worse disease hit you. And sure, it might be a genetic predisposition, but it's the lifestyle that triggers it in most cases. It's the lifestyle, and you can reverse that too. Instead of partying, eating like crap, how about do something good for your body? We'll be right back. This is the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. Lots more news to cover. Lots more fun. All right, I'll tell you what. We're going to go ahead and play that video here in a second from Kit Daniels about how people are so disconnected from reality. They don't even have physical connection anymore with human beings or communication. But first, I want to remind you, Vitamin Mineral Fusion is back at InfoWarsLife.com. The multivitamin drink mix. Really, really great. You got to check it out for yourself. It's back in stock. It will be out soon. No question. So check it out. Vitamin Mineral Fusion, InfoWarsLife.com. And here's the video from Kit Daniels. Physical interaction is dead.
Why are more men now watching pornography instead of meeting women? And why are more men now watching sports to experience thrill and a tribal sense of belonging instead of being active outdoors? Why do both men and women text each other instead of having more personal face-to-face conversations? Why do people play video games to experience adventure and a sense of accomplishment instead of being active in the physical world? And why do people watch TV to feel emotions by living vicariously through fictional characters? It all boils down to this one question. Why are people now content to be mere spectators in life instead of actively experiencing reality for themselves? Third wave feminism can take a lot of blame for this, as now that you see that men and women don't even know how to act around one another, you see that marriages and birth rates are both on the decline, like I mentioned in a previous video. But there's more to this problem than just feminism. As blogger Corey Savage points out, there's been an extensive transformation creeping into how we live our lives. It's called the rise of the anti-physical culture. Unlike our hunting-gathering ancestors, whose physical activity meant the difference between life and death, we have allowed the division of labor to transform us into shiftless sloths. But as bodybuilder Mark Ripiteau once pointed out, our rugged physical existence won't just disappear because deaths were invented. And that's why mental illness is so prevalent today. Our bodies yearn for physical activity, yet we sit stationary in front of computers and smartphones, feeding our minds the equivalent of electronic junk food from Netflix to porn, as Sandy Mann with The Guardian points out. Although we seem to live in a varied and exciting world with a wealth of entertainment at our fingertips, this is actually the problem. Many of these amusements are obtained in remarkably similar ways, via our fingers. We spend much of our work life now tapping away at our keyboard. We then look for stimulation, watching movies, reading books, catching the news, interacting with friends via the internet or our phone, which means more tapping. On average, we spend 6 to 7 hours in front of our phone, tablet, computer, and TV screens every day. Simply put, we're living our lives contrary to our physical nature, turning our bodies into blobs and our minds into mush. So is it really that surprising then that so many people now suffer from depression, anxiety, and attention spans shorter than a goldfish? Case in point, a couple of months ago, I was at a swing dance event here in Austin, Texas, and I saw this one girl in particular who was there dressed to dance. But instead, she spent the whole night by this dance floor tapping away on her smartphone and checking Facebook. And I'm sure you've had similar experiences yourself. We're not unphysical, we're anti-physical. Our zombie inactive lifestyles are not only destroying our health, but also our human experience. We're so addicted to our fake worlds that the real world seems boring in comparison. Instead of enjoying the warmth of the sun and the subtleties of the breeze, we panic if we can't check our Facebook accounts every 5 minutes. And men in particular are less attracted to women in real life because they see thousands of photos and videos of scantily clad women who exist to them only as mere pixels. To sum it up, we're replacing real-life, tangible life experiences with the fantasy world. And no matter how much we lie to ourselves, our subconscious knows the truth. And the political establishment wants this. They want people who are mere spectators in life who can't challenge the system. And compare this to our founding fathers who revolted against the British Empire. They were constantly on the move throughout the colonies, assembling makeshift militias to defend not only their rights, but also their homes while battling frostbite, disease, and hunger. And yet these were common everyday people. So how are they any different than people you'd run into, say, today at the coffee shop? Simple, they lived a physical life. They weren't distracted by social media or TV or football or porn. They lived life in the physical world with the entirety of their being, where their mind, body, and soul were interconnected. They didn't need TV shows or video
games.
We'll
give you the rest of that video. Check it out on YouTube on the Real Alex Jones channel. That's just the Alex Jones channel by Kit Daniels. What a poignant, key notion. People are afraid of human contact. They're so desperately afraid of it. I mean, if you walk someone on the street, I actually wanted to do a video. Go talk to random people on the street. They're like, whoa, what? Is a human being speaking to me? Oh, my God, what do I do? Complete shutdown of social interaction and reality. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Thank you so much for watching. And Alex will be back from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central Standard tomorrow. This is the Alex Jones.